forgiven. But you've made it this far, so how far can you go?
In their home, away from home, it's another game for the Pittsburgh Panthers here at Madison Square Garden in New York, where they've won 21 games in the last 8 years. But don't sell the Louisville Cardinals short. They've got a lot of New York City connections as well. A berth in the Big East semifinals is on the line. Welcome to continuing coverage of Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Quarterfinal action from the Big East Championship presented by Aeropostale. Our first of two games here tonight from the Garden, Pittsburgh and Louisville. They meet for the third consecutive year in the Big East Championship, with Pittsburgh winning each of the last 2 years. Here's a look at the action from earlier today. Georgetown got by a determined Villanova team to move into the semifinals. West Virginia, at least according to the seeding, with an upset today over UConn, another monster day for Joe Alexander as they advance to the semifinals. Hi, everybody. Dan Shulman and Len Elmore. Glad to have you with us here in New York City for two quarterfinal games here tonight. And Rick Pitino is glad to be coaching a game here at Madison Square Garden. He's got a lot of New York City connections. He was born just a few blocks from MSG. He played high school ball out on Long Island from Oyster Bay and, of course, was both the assistant coach and the head coach of the New York Knicks. He's got family here in the area. It's always special for Rick Pitino to coach in New York. And unlike some coaches who tend to look past conference tournaments sometimes, just looking at the NCAA tournament, the big prize is still out there, but Rick Pitino loves conference tournaments.
Well, he's a native New Yorker, and he understands that winning a championship in New York, it's special, it's sacred. And we're talking about the history of the game, the precedents, the players that have come before, and Rick's desire, he's a native son, he hopes that desire rubs off on his guys, particularly the ones who are from the metro area.
Now all you have to do is look at the success that Pittsburgh has had in this tournament, reaching the championship game 6 of the last 7 years, to know what this means to that program under Ben Howland, and now, of course, the last 5 years under Jamie Dixon. And Coach Dixon is feeling pretty good about things. He says, Len, his team is playing as well right now as they have all season.
And he points to the defense particularly. The guys are meshing. They're playing well, communicating. And it's going to be important because the last time these two teams met, Louisville shot 58% from the field. And also, Pittsburgh would love to exhibit that patience they exhibited yesterday against Cincinnati, making the extra pass and really building lead. So it's going to work for Jamie Dixon if his guys can continue that kind of play.
It was a great game during the regular season. Louisville winning by 2 in Pittsburgh as we check out our Star Watch presented by MLB 2K8.
Well, Dwan Blair, co-rookie of the year, vital to Pittsburgh's attack on both ends. 20 points, 11 rebounds last time these guys met. And David Padgett, maybe the MVC, most valuable Cardinal, for his leadership and his production. 21 points against Pitt the last time they met.
Well, there's no disputing who the most valuable member of our crew is. Let's
Absolutely.
Say hello to Doris Burke. Doris.
Very nice introduction, Dan. The Louisville Cardinal in the month of January went 3-6 overall, but it was the final game of that particular month, a road loss at Connecticut, that proved to be the turning point for the Louisville Cardinal. Rick Pitino on the charter flight home individually took players up to the middle of the plane to discuss shot selection. He and his team, their mantra from that point forward, no contested shots. It's translated to 49% shooting and 9 straight wins. And they believe their success now and through the NCAA tournament will be predicated on what kinds of shots they get.
Doris, tonight's starting lineups are presented by Aeropostale and a couple of experienced teams, 2 seniors, 2 juniors, and the co-rookie of the year in the Big East this year for Pittsburgh, that's Dwan Blair. And for Louisville, a lot of experience as well, especially up front with David Padgett, Juan Palacios getting the start, the versatile Terrence Williams on the wing, and Andre McGee and Jerry Smith in the backcourt. Tonight's game between Pittsburgh and Louisville is also available in sparkling high definition on ESPN HD, brought to you by Olivia. The first of two with Marquette and Notre Dame still to come tonight from the Garden, and we are underway with Louisville wearing white getting the tip.
Well, one of the big matchups that we need to watch, as we mentioned before, Dwan Blair, a rookie, against David Padgett, the senior. Almost identical numbers for these guys the last time they met. Pittsburgh in man-to-man. Blair is going to have to continue to understand and learn on the fly against a more experienced package.
Palacios with a strong move inside. You see the color coordinated brace he's got on his right knee. More knee problems this year for Palacios. Missed 9 games early in the season, but looking to go out in his senior season in style. We've got a hell of a ball to stay with Pittsburgh, but early pressure from Louisville.
Well, Louisville, they build their attack on defense. Third in the Big East behind Georgetown and UConn in field goal percentage defense. It's all about disruption. Getting out, playing a variety of defenses, zones, man, pressure. Just make you have to think. And when you think, sometimes you think long and wrong.
And those top three in the Big East are all in the top 5 nationally in opponents' field goal percentage. They all hold their opponents well under 40%. You'll see a lot of different defensive looks from the Cardinals tonight. Desperation three from Ramon, and it's out of bounds off the fingertips of Patchett. Back to Pitt, coached by Jamie Dixon. Fifth season and an incredible record. Great success, as much regular season success along with UConn as any team in the Big East during his tenure, and great postseason success here in New York as well. What a tap by DeJuan Blair, who's already got more points tonight than he had last night against Cincinnati.
I think DeJuan Blair wants to get off to a good start, also recognizing with this Louisville defense, you're going to have to go to the offensive glass. That first look may not be the best look, and you're going to have to get second, third chance opportunity.
Great pressure by Keith Benjamin on Terrence Williams way out of the perimeter. That's an interesting matchup. Williams is as versatile a talent as there is in the league. 6'6", athletic, great passer, good rebounder. Can put the ball on the floor. Benjamin's got his work cut out for him. Padgett inside from Williams.
Well, Vance Fields did a nice job of getting there to help, but David Padgett avoiding the contact. Experience understands that guys are going to step underneath and extend it and drop it in. And again, you can see the full court pressure going to zone, and Pittsburgh kind of not really playing comfortably.
And Louisville in a bit of a rush. They turn it over. Let's go back to David Padgett at the other end. He means more to this team than just numbers.
Well, he certainly does. He knows where to be. He knows how to get their offense started. As you saw there, he's a beneficiary of just bringing the ball, getting it to a pass, and then rolling.
And I'm not sure there's another high-level team in the country where you could say their two best passers are both front-court players. Louisville with Terrence Williams at forward.
Nice fake.
Yep, David Padgett at center. We talked about that shot fake extensively last night by Sam Young, and a very experienced David Padgett just picked.
Well, I'll tell you again, Sam Young saw that. Watch him pump fake, and look at David Padgett stand straight up. And when he goes straight up, that's when Sam Young can use his quickness to get to the basket.
And if you've never seen that move before by Young, it looks like he's leaving the ground. The ball goes way up. The left foot comes off the ground, but the toes of the right foot stay on the ground. And I almost wonder if they go to the officials before the game and say, listen, this is his move. Here's what he does. Look at him. He's not leaving the floor, because everybody on the other team sure thinks he's leaving the ground.
But it's very effective. Oh, again, yeah. Getting defenders to raise up, get their center of gravity higher, and then he's allowed to blow by you.
Young, the most improved player in the Big East this year, 18 points per game. He comes up with a steal. He had 4 blocks last night, 3 of them right near the end of the game, to preserve the win over the Bearcats. Blair, the double team, and he muscles his way through it.
Well, again, we told you at the beginning of the telecast, last time these teams met, DeJuan Blair, 20 points, 11 rebounds. And now you see Pittsburgh making a concerned effort to get to him, and he's delivering. Quick moves down low, going after the big people.
And away from the ball, the foul on Benjamin of Pittsburgh.
We're going to take a look at DeJuan Blair right here. Nice feed. And he's already got a drop step on the baseline and just uses his muscle under control to bump Padgett back. That's a good offensive move. Some people might think it's an offensive charge, but in the end, it comes down to the defender having to give round.
They desperately have to keep Blair out of foul trouble and keep him in the game. An air ball from the corner by Andre McGee. Ronald Ramon, the kick to Fields for 3. It goes, and he's fouled. we have an opportunity right now to see our third four-point play in the three games that we've done.
Very unusual, and certainly coaches. And McGee got pretty close. He might have brushed him with the hairs on his arm. But just enough for the official to make the call. You know, you don't want to foul a jump shooter. Certainly Louisville wants to bother the shooters. Again, they wouldn't be this good a defensive team if they did get right up close.
Solid game last night for Fields. And in the game against Louisville during the regular season, even though Pittsburgh didn't win, Fields didn't turn it over once as Earl Clark is into the game and immediately, as they say, announces his presence with authority.
Well, that's another guy. Maybe Pitt doesn't have an answer for Earl Clark, the athleticism, the length.
Clark, a 6'9 sophomore from Plainfield, New Jersey. Each team has about five players from the greater New York City area. So this is a very big game for them, both for their teams. Here comes another one in Edgar Sosa out of Rice High here in New York City. And so many of these players, led. They would have grown up playing against each other in AAU and high school. These guys all know each other.
Well, and during the warm-ups, a number of them yelled back and forth to guys, calling them by pet names, so you know they know each other.
David Padgett, the assist. Earl Clark's been in the game 30 seconds. He's got two dunks.
And again, he may be the guy that Pittsburgh doesn't have an answer for at 6'8", 6'9", with that length and that athleticism. But again, we talked about the offense going through David Padgett. Take a look at him at the high post. He's the conduit or the hub, and everything flows through him. The guards don't have to worry so much about penetration when they get it to the big fella.
Fouls on Jerry Smith of Louisville. An 8-8 tie, third year of the Big East for Louisville. Third year in a row they have played Pittsburgh in the Big East Championship, eliminated by Pitt each of the first 2 years. The rebound to Jerry Smith off the miss by Young, and a reach-in foul on Benjamin, his second already. Got a good start here inside the Garden. Both teams in a rhythm early in this one.
Miss Davis, this is OnStar. I've received a signal you've been in a crash. I'm contacting emergency services.
OnStar reporting a front-end crash on Wakefield Road.
Chevy Malibu, airbags deployed, injuries reported. Please respond.
Ma'am, help is on the way.
And I'll stay on the line with you till we get there.
Automatic crash response, built into 11 Chevy models.
Switch to Valvoline's Max Life. And there's no telling how long your car will keep going. MaxLife not only protects against friction, but also leaks, deposits, and sludge. The four major causes of high-mileage engine breakdown. Drive it forever.
Hold on. Preparing for a ride.
Tomorrow, doomsday is coming. There'll be panic, murder, public disorder. And that's just for starters.
It's just what girl needs.
Doomsday. Rated R.
Enjoy the show.
Check card, because every second counts. Life takes action. Life takes Visa.
The NCAA Women's Basketball Championship, March 22nd through April 8th.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Aeropostale. Make it happen. And in part by OnStar by GM. To learn more, visit OnStar.com. And Valvoline's Max Life. Drive it forever.
Welcome back to New York City. Tied at 8 early between Pittsburgh and Louisville. The winner goes to the semifinals tomorrow night. Two of our semifinalists have already been determined with a look back at the daytime session. Jonathan Wallace, Jesse Sapp, and the Hoyas were drilling them from outside as they beat Villanova 82-63 in the second quarterfinal today. Joe Alexander, who might be the hottest player in the country right now, 34 points. West Virginia defeats UConn 78-72. Georgetown ties a tournament record, sets a school record with 17 made three-pointers as they run away late from Villanova, and a pretty impressive performance in a foul-filled game by West Virginia. If there was any doubt about the Mountaineers being in, there isn't anymore.
Oh, absolutely not. And when you talk about Joe Alexander, Absolutely. This guy has made tremendous strides. And I've done about five of the West Virginia games. I'm sure four of them they wished I was never there since they lost them. But in the end, the only improvement I think that Alexander's made, whether it's consciously or not, was arc on his jump shot. And that has changed it dramatically. He is such a more confident player right now. It's unbelievable what he's been able to do.
Edgar Sosa, a three for Louisville. Gilbert Brown into the game for Pittsburgh. Keith Benjamin has gone to the bench with two fouls. The Cardinals in a 2-3 zone.
And it's not a passive 2-3. They'll get out W. They'll get out and pressure you.
Padgett bit on that shot fake again by Young. Shot clock into single digits. Ramon for three. And the long rebound run down by Sam Young.
And you could say running the shot clock down on a number of these possessions Pittsburgh's had. And it's designed. They want to be patient. But Louisville really confusing them and forcing that long shot.
Gilbert Brown, the redshirt freshman, misses the three. And what a battle for the ball. Terrence Williams and DeJuan Blair. It'll go over to the Cardinals.
It's one thing to have patience to get a good shot, usually inside the paint against the zone. It's another to settle as you take a look at the battle with Blair, who steps out of bounds. So even a simultaneous possession, because Blair is out of bounds, the ball is off him.
Blair, better than 9 rebounds per game this year as a freshman, had 20 in this building against Duke back in December. A 6'7", 265-pound bundle of strength and energy. A foul against Pitt, says Michael Stevens, working the game along with Jim Burr and Bob Donato. Well, ESPN will have both semifinal games for the Big East Championship, presented by Aeropostale, tomorrow night. We know the first game in Georgetown and West Virginia. The winner of this one against the winner of our next game tonight, Notre Dame and Marquette. The Big East Championship presented by Aeropostale, all a part of Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods on ESPN.
And now you got David Padgett with LeVance Fields fronting him right down on the low block. And you look in the high-low right there.
Jerry Smith, who has not been shooting the ball well the last couple of games, had a great look. He started the season slowly, was red hot for a while, but his last two games coming into this one, man, 1 out of 13 from beyond the arc.
And Louisville could definitely use Jerry Smith as a great example of him being able to stretch the defenses and keep them off the big guys.
Young misses the three. Pittsburgh may fall into a pattern if they're going to see a lot of zone, and it's man right now. But if they're going to see a lot of zone, of taking a lot of threes. Now a call against Louisville. It's going to be on Will Clark is first. The numbers for Jerry Smith. And it's not a great shooting team, but he might be the best of the bunch.
Yeah, 38% on the course of the year. And in 11 of the last 14, he's been shooting 50% or better. But that was before this game, 0-7. And he's thinking about it. You could tell it was a wide open shot that he should have at least gone higher.
Ronald Ramon for three. The senior is third on Pitt's all-time three-pointer list, better than 220. Made threes in his career. LeVance Fields just picked up his second foul, I believe. And Fields is really upset. And he's got to come out.
Take a look at Ramon coming off the double. And a nice job on the inbounds play. And boy, there was contact, obviously, when you're going after the ball. Two guys going after the ball, it will be contact. I think it was the resting of the right arm on the offensive player's back that got the call.
Derek Character up and under and in. What a sweet move by Character, loaded with talent, coming off the bench the second half of the year for Louisville after Padgett came back. And by and large, Len, Character has done what Rick Pitino's wanted him to do. He was suspended for one game early, but he has generally met the conditions that Rick Pitino has demanded of him.
Well, and he's been playing about 19 minutes a game. And lately, he's come in and been very efficient. We saw an opportunity for him there that he capitalized on. But that's part of Louisville's success, having this depth. A guy like Character who can play limited minutes, be efficient, and spell David Patrick.
Terrence Williams through the hands of Earl Clark. Edgar Sosa for three. In and out, rebound Ramon, who now assumes the point guard duties with Fields on the bench with two fouls.
And you know what? That is the positive side of the LeVance Fields injury. Develop more versatility. Ronald Ramon now a consummate point guard. And a 3-1 assist to turnover ratio during the time LeVance Fields was out and Ramon was running the point.
Yeah, he helped them to an 8-4 record in those 12 games. Brad Wanamaker with the ball. And a block by Character. The Pittsburgh bench thinking maybe that ball was on the way down. Sosa absorbs the bump. No call. It doesn't drop, and back come the Panthers in what is becoming an increasingly physical affair.
Another ball fake by Sam Young gets the defender off his feet and allows Young to create that play. I was going to say, when Character was 300 pounds, he would have never gotten up to get that shot. Might not have gotten to the corner, bottom corner of the backboard.
Gilbert Brown gives Pittsburgh the lead. Off to a good start, these two teams here tonight. Earl Clark with his third field goal of the night to tie it again.
Not necessarily the pace that Pittsburgh wants to play, although against the ball, they played it and played it well, scoring 98 points the last game of the regular season. But much more comfortable playing the way they're playing now, more deliberate.
Pittsburgh trying to avenge a regular season defeat to the Cardinals. Louisville trying to avenge back-to-back losses in this tournament the last 2 years to Pittsburgh. Sam Young knocks down the 15-footer. Dewan Blair getting set to check back in for the Panthers. Justin Knowles with the ball, a tenacious defender. He is tripped by Sam Young. A foul on Young. Pittsburgh leading by two. The last bucket for Pittsburgh to Young. First team all Big East performer playing like it early here tonight.
Miss Davis, this is OnStar. I've received a signal you've been in a crash. I'm contacting emergency services.
OnStar reporting a front-end crash on Wakefield Road.
Chevy Malibu, airbags deployed, injuries reported.
Ma'am, help is on the way.
And I'll stay on the line with you till we get there.
Automatic crash response, built into 11 Chevy models.
Your evil art is complete.
Now, nothing can stop me from building my own Capital One credit card.
Make my rewards double point and a low interest rate.
What? And I want a picture of kittens on it.
War kittens?
Just like regular cute kittens. Baby cats?
Introducing Capital One Card Lab. Customize your card by choosing your rewards, interest rate, even upload your own image at CapitalOne.com.
What's in your wallet?
ESPN Films presents Black Magic. 3 years after Jackie Robinson broke Major League Baseball's color barrier, Earl Lloyd earned pioneer status himself. Picked by the Washington Capitals in the 1950 draft, the West Virginia State star became the first African-American to play in the NBA.
Great common denominator is when you scrimmage and they throw the ball up, we all eat.
Black Magic debuts March 16th at 9 Eastern on ESPN.
Well, Len, I know you've seen part of the show, 2 hours Sunday, 2 hours on a Monday. Jackie Robinson's name is a household name. Earl Lloyd's isn't, and maybe we should learn a little bit more about him.
Well, Earl Lloyd, as mentioned in that promo, from West Virginia State, highly educated, very, very well-spoken. And when I say well-spoken, obviously he's a college graduate, but more importantly, he gets right down to it. He's a tremendous speaker to young people across the country. I've had many opportunities to sit down with Earl. And I'll tell you what, he's a guy that understands what it means to be a pioneer and a representative group. And his strength and his courage, obviously, is something that you can just see when you look at him and talk to him.
Black Magic Sunday night at 9 for 2 hours, and then again a Monday night at 9 here on ESPN. Terrence Williams with a block.
if there is a player who enjoys himself more on the court than Terrence Williams, I'm not sure we've met him, Len, as Biggs misses the jumper. T-Will, as he's known, just loves to play, and he's really had a terrific year. He's not looking to score as much, has become a willing distributor, and has had two triple-doubles this year for the Cardinals. Clark is fouled. Gilbert Brown will be called for the foul for Pittsburgh. Well, let's give you a biography of Terrence Williams. He's a junior, second-team All-Big East selection from Seattle. Two triple-doubles, as we mentioned, two of the four in Louisville basketball history, made the all-tournament team last year. A guy with great energy, a hard worker.
And he's a guy who's accepting his role now on this team. The guy who does a little bit of everything, utility man. You see Derek Character power his way for a couple of points. Last year, Terrence Williams thought he was a three-point shooter. Thought he had to take the open shots, never used his athleticism to the extent he is now. But under Rick Pitino, he's really blossomed into an all-round player.
Now, Len, you've done a number of Louisville games this year, as have I. Have you ever seen Clark, Character, Palacios, three of the four bigs on the floor at the same time?
It's been rare if it's happened at all. But, again, when you look at him in the aggregate, with that size on that back line, and not only size, but the width of Character and Palacios, you got a couple of bangers in there that make it rough.
It's a 6'9", 6'8", 6'8", back line right now for Louisville. That foul goes on Palacios, his first, fifth on the team.
I could see them softening up the opponent's front line and Earl Clark coming in and reaping the benefits with that eagle wing spread.
Juwan Blair's got his work cut out for him tonight. He'll get some help, but he does not have as much help up front, as much size up front as the Cardinals do it. Right now, Sam Young is on the bench. Tyrell Biggs is in there, another big body, 6'8", 245 for Pittsburgh.
Well, this is why it's hard for Blair, because he's playing David Padgett, who's more of a finesse kind of guy, passing the ball and others. Now he's got to play a Derek Character. He just wants to bang. Blair's holding his own right now. You look at these guys, man. I can feel the rumble over here.
Clark with a great feed, and Character is going to be shooting free throws. Their Character giving Louisville some very good minutes tonight.
Well, you take a look right here. Look at the bang right there. Character wants to get the first one. And here comes Blair over to make sure the Character earns it on the free throw line. But those two big bodies, I don't know.
First foul on DeJuan Blair as we go to Doris Burke.
Well, you guys have touched on this briefly. In his tenure at Louisville, Derek Character has spent a good portion of his time in Rick Pitino's doghouse. A variety of issues, guys. His physique, as you look at him here on the free throw line, drastically different than when he arrived at Louisville. He has struggled with weight management issues and other team expectations. But nothing like a treadmill where Rick Pitino has it courtside. If he gets in trouble, he can always go to that, gentlemen.
Yeah, but I think with both he and DeJuan Blair, somebody.
Oh, Palacios misses the dunk after a great steal, and Clark banks it home.
I was just about to say somebody had to pull out the Richter scale with Blair and Character banging each other, but Palacios was about to tear down the rim here. It took off maybe a step too soon. But nonetheless, Derek Smith makes up for it with the delivery to Clark.
Clark misses the free throw. If you're Rick Pitino, you've got to love how active Character, Palacios, and Clark have been tonight. Brown off to Blair, who is fouled.
Well, DeJuan Blair's smiling, too. I think he likes the contact. In the end, though, he's going to accept the challenge. You know, changing up on him, different styles between Padgett and Character. DeJuan Blair has to stay on the floor for Pittsburgh. There's not a whole lot of breathing room he's going to have in a game like this. He might get a blow here and there.
Double team, triple teamed against Cincinnati last night. Did not make a field goal. He is absolutely pivotal to the success of Pittsburgh here tonight. What's at stake tonight? A berth in the semifinals. And there he is, right between free throws, maybe waving to somebody he knows in the crowd. The young man has a good time out there. Pittsburgh and Louisville for the Big East Championship, presented by Aeropostale, along with Len Elmore, Doris Burke. I'm Dan Shulman. Quarterfinal number three. Marquette and Notre Dame, our next quarterfinal tonight. The winner of this plays the winner of that, and a semifinal tomorrow night. We already know it'll be Georgetown and West Virginia in the other semifinal tomorrow night, 7 Eastern, here on ESPN.
When you talk about what's at stake, the subtext is all these New Yorkers need something to brag about.
That's right.
As I said, before the game, these guys were yelling at each other, calling them their pet names.
Held the ball. It'll stay with Louisville.
Talk about being physical right there. Look at that screen. They're a character knowing how to throw the weight around.
When Louisville gets good minutes from the likes of Character and Palacios to go along with Clark and Apache up front, that's as deep and diverse a quartet of big guys as maybe any team in the country has. And this is about as active and healthy looking as I've seen Palacios in a long, long time.
Look at Character calling for it. This is a challenge for Derek Character right here. Seeing a guy his size, about his width, having a terrific year. And Character also wants to be able to prove something, but oh man.
Now the glass is there for a reason, I guess, huh?
Yeah, so that ball doesn't go on the 50th row.
Blair not even smiling. Maybe he's trying to sell that he tried to do that. Maybe Jamie Dixon feeling this is danger time. He's got Fields back in there, but it's two fouls as Palacios lays in the reverse.
Look at the double team right there, making Fields work.
And a foul on Terrence Williams, reaching in on Sam Young. Louisville and Pittsburgh in a good one. The reality is somebody's going home after tonight.
When the dream that drives you is closer to reality, that's what this show is about.
You want reality TV?
Well, here it is.
You want reality TV?
Well, here it is.
You want reality TV?
Well, here it is.
The Big East on ESPN, that's where it lives.
Miss Davis, this is OnStar. I've received a signal you've been in a crash. I'm contacting emergency services.
OnStar reporting a front-end crash on Wakefield Road.
Chevy Malibu, airbags deployed, injuries reported.
Ma'am, help is on the way.
And I'll stay on the line with you till we get there.
Automatic crash response, built into 11 Chevy models.
The NASCAR Nationwide Series on ABC. Red Hot Kyle Busch eyes the points lead as NASCAR goes rubbing and racing at the world's fastest half mile. Bristol, the NASCAR Nationwide Series, Saturday at 2 Eastern on ABC.
Now, every season is football season. From aerial attacks to awesome moves. Watch Russell Athletic ESPN Arena Football Monday at 8 as the Colorado Crush battle the Dallas Desperados on ESPN2.
In her hometown, she's a hero.
I had this dream where you went off to California and met that guy on Smallville.
He's not my type.
You have a type?
At her new school, she's a zero.
Obviously, someone here needs a little help with their walk.
She's my sister, but I also think she might be the devil.
But she's going to show them all what Nancy Drew can do.
If I'm not back in 10 minutes, that means something bad's happened.
I don't think that was a joke.
Nancy Drew. Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
Did you know that when your business advertises, you may not be getting your whole market? And what if every time you ordered something, you got a little less than you expected? Via Media offers affordable local television advertising on major cable networks to local, regional, and national businesses. And Via Media now offers advertising on Verizon Fios. At Via Media, we think your business advertising deserves the whole market. Via Media, more of the big picture.
I'm Reese Davis, SportsCenter right now. No Curt Schilling until at least the All-Star break for the Red Sox. The 41-year-old has been placed on the 60-day disabled list in order to rehabilitate his right shoulder. The Yankees had a new leadoff man, one time only, Billy Crystal. Crystal, he did not look so marvelous. He struck out against Paul Mahomes wearing number 60 one day before his 60th birthday, but Crystal did hit a foul ball during the at-bat. SportsCenter, 11 p.m. on ESPN News. Stay current, and stay current all the time with ESPN News.
Well, I would consider a foul ball a moral victory stepping in there against a major league pitcher. And on a more serious note, while we're talking to baseball, we'd like to send out our best to our friend and colleague Rick Sutcliffe. People may have seen today, ESPN put out a release. Sut has a treatable, thankfully, a treatable form of colon cancer and is going to be undergoing treatment immediately and will not be a part, obviously. He's been a huge part of our baseball coverage on ESPN for many, many years. And we wish him a speedy and full recovery. And Sut, we hope to see you back on the air very, very soon.
I sentiments exactly.
Here for the Garden, quarterfinal action of the Big East Championship presented by Aeropostal. Louisville 22, Pittsburgh 21. The winner plays the winner of Marquette and Notre Dame in a semifinal tomorrow night. Terrence Williams misses the three. Blair got a finger on it. Ramon comes up with a loose ball.
And here's where DeJuan Blair shouldn't change a thing after battling with character. He's now matched up with David Padgett again. May not be as physical, but certainly a little more cerebral. And there's Blair battling Padgett down low.
He is a load, isn't he?
And that time, a little bit of guile. DeJuan Blair walked Padgett under the basket and got him out of position for that rebound. So he's making the adjustment.
And let me add to something I said. Terrence Williams has some company. Terrence Williams and DeJuan Blair. If there were two guys to share an award for having the most fun while playing basketball, they're both in this game tonight.
Oh, look at that take.
Blair misses the follow, and it'll be Louisville ball.
A little too nonchalant on that one. Instead of powering up, he got a little finesse. But look at him walk David Padgett under the basket to get that rebound. He said, yeah, I did it. But he wasn't smiling after that point-blank miss because I think he relaxed too much. And that's what I mean by the adjustment. He's not going to relax on character because you can't. You might get banged. And with David Padgett, maybe he thinks he can relax, but then it affects the other parts of the game.
Louisville, the number two seed. Pittsburgh, the number seven seed in the loaded Big East. Sosa misses a three. Padgett, a great offensive rebound. Sosa passes it up. The penetration, the floater by Terrence Williams, not there. Rebound, Sam Young. Fields pushes it ahead to Keith Benjamin. He and Fields, both in the game in the first half, playing with two fouls.
And when you watch Louisville on that last possession, you're watching Pittsburgh. The ball movement, the unselfishness of sharing is unbelievable. 9 field goals for Pittsburgh, 7 assists, 10 field goals. I was going to say make it 11, but the fumble, the 10 Louisville field goals and 9 assists on them.
Earl Clark had a gimme and fumbled it away after a great feed from Edgar Sosa. ESPN and ESPN2's coverage of Championship Week continues tomorrow with the Big Ten and ACC quarterfinal games. First at noon Eastern on ESPN2, North Carolina will take on Florida State, which advanced with a win over Wake Forest today. Then it'll be Ohio State and Michigan State in a pivotal game for the Buckeyes. 2 o'clock Eastern right here on ESPN. Ohio State has had some nice wins recently. Earlier today, Joe Lunardi had Ohio State as one of his last 4 out of the tournament. So in his opinion, they need a win. They need another win over Michigan State. If you're talking about bubbles, if you're a bracketologist, an amateur bracketologist, Villanova here lost to Georgetown today. Baylor lost to Colorado today in the Big 12 tournament. Arizona State, a bubble team, lost to USC. UAB lost to Tulsa. And Dayton lost to Xavier. So, I mean, who knows who's going to get in? The bracketologists tell me, Len, that the bubble is weaker this year than it generally has been.
And probably less teams on it.
And travel on Palacios. And I think your word of the week has been fluid. This is a fluid situation, right?
Yeah, and these losses change a lot of things. You know, a lot of people are saying that Villanova's still in the picture in many reasons because of some of these losses right here. Teams who are somewhat comparable.
Pittsburgh turns it over.
Keith Benjamin trying to get the ball to the middle. The defender popped in there at the last moment. I think it was Palacios. And Benjamin had already committed. That's why he tried to get it someplace else. You cannot leave your feet against this Rick Pitino pressure because these guys are shifting from spot to spot.
Patch it off to Sosa. He'll pass up the jumper for Jerry Smith, who will knock it down.
And watching Jerry Smith from behind and look at that form and that touch. He was more relaxed in that shot than probably any shot he's taken in the last 2 games.
And Rick Pitino's got to be thrilled. Edgar Sosa had a shot, but passed off to a better shooter in Jerry Smith. And that's what they've been trying to get through to Sosa, not to think of his own offense so much, to share the ball. And he's done a better job of it in the second half of the season. The foul on David Padgett as we check in with Doris Burke.
Well, the last time these two teams met, it was a 2-point game. But one of the keys for Pittsburgh was spacing against the pressure. And Levance Fields has no one near him, Len. When he's dribbling the basketball, you see Pittsburgh's players depart the area. There's no one within about 25 or 30 feet of them. They've only got four turnovers.
Well, you got to give a creator room to work. You know, the artist needs a little bit of space.
Fields sitting down, Ramon back in. Jamie Dixon wanted to play it a little bit carefully with Fields having a couple of fouls. Biggs misses two free throws.
But seriously, Doris is absolutely right. That is the key to efficient offense. Good passing is really about good spacing, giving guys room to work, keeping the help away, making it come a long way, and then you can find the open man.
Padgett misses the jump hook, and back come the Panthers looking to take the lead.
Nice.
Biggs inside.
And that's a great example of the spacing, stretching out the defense so you have passing lanes, you have cutting areas, and spaces where the passers can find them.
And Sam Young found him beautifully. An assist for Young. Pittsburgh by a deuce.
Nice
feed close from Sosa to Palacios. Boy, this has been a passing clinic here tonight.
So fundamentally sound are both these teams.
Gotta love teams sharing the basketball. Pittsburgh leading by two.
There's no looking back now. The time to let your resume speak for itself is here. Which teams will be granted a spot in the bracket?
That is a very tough first round matchup.
Who will be left out in the cold?
They got a raw deal.
This is the team that has the easiest way to get back to the Final Four.
65 schools have a chance to cut down the nets. Our team will prepare you to pick one champion. ESPN U Bracketology, presented by Staples. Sunday at 7 on ESPN, followed by Black Magic Part 1.
Six players do not make a team if they don't work together. They're just six individuals in matching uniforms. At Oppenheimer Funds, our investment professionals work hand in hand, sharing more than a common goal, sharing the skills that can lead to success. Oppenheimer Funds, the right way to invest.
Carefully consider fund investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses. Call your advisor for a prospectus with this and other fund information. Read it carefully before investing.
Sure can brew it.
Question is, can you sell it?
Made our first sale.
More bars in more places. Wherever your business takes you, depend on the network you can trust.
Am I going too fast for you?
Switch to AT&T.
We gotta celebrate.
We gotta expand.
AT&T, your world delivered. Get our exclusive Walkman slider for only $49.99.
Cisco halftime report coming up in just a little bit. Reese Davis, Digger Phelps, and Bob Knight. Look at what's happened. Coach Knight's been here for a day, and all of a sudden you're without the jacket.
Tie goes next. Highlighter's out the window.
We can only hope about the highlighter.
You hanging in there, all right? This is night two now. Come on, we got another 40 days to go.
I think of what goes next. Let's get rid of the tie first.
We'll see if Digger has on his tie. Going to keep everything else on too, I promise. We'll see you at halftime, guys.
Excuse me?
Just saying.
All right, Reese, looking forward to the halftime. Two-point lead with Pittsburgh over Louisville. The Big East Championship presented by Aeropostale. Quarterfinal action. Our big man talking about Pittsburgh's big man.
Well, the young man is establishing himself down there, backing the veteran David Padgett down under the basket. Quick move on the perimeter to get his shot off. And just as importantly, use a little bit of guile walking David Padgett under the basket. And you talk about enjoying this ball game, just a smile on his face every play.
Let's bring in Doris Burke with more.
Well, there was some concern about DeJuan Blair at 6'7" being able to be successful against higher level competition. A 20 rebound, 15 point effort against Duke gave early notice that this guy would indeed be successful. When I asked him about being undersized earlier this year, he said, "It's simply not a concern for me. I have a 7'3" wingspan and my heart is big. I'm not afraid of anybody and I play like I'm 6'10". Lenny, there's some truth to that.
Especially with that wingspan. I mean, I've always maintained, people talk about, well, Well, he's 6'9", he's 6'10". When you're talking about an inch or two or maybe three, that really means nothing. You can put cushions in your sneakers and bring you up to 6'10", but it's all about the reach, especially for rebounding.
Blair, the first Pittsburgh City League product to play at the University of Pittsburgh in 16 years. An all-state caliber player, won a state championship last year, played at Shenley High School, less than a mile away from the Peterson Event Center.
Take a look at Padgett right there. He gets the ball at the high post. He's surveying the floor, seeing if there's a play that he can make.
Well, a battle inside between Padgett and Blair. Blair comes up with a loose ball. Fourth in the Big East Conference in steals this year for the big guy. A couple of key players, Fields for Pittsburgh, Clark for Louisville, each on the bench with two fouls apiece. Let's revisit that battle on the inside at the other end.
Well, you're going to take a look at Blair go from side to side, doesn't let David Padgett know where he is, and finally when the pass is made, his footwork gets him in front, and he makes the steal. And that's the thing about this young man that is so impressive, the fact that he understands the cerebral part of the game, how to get his opponent off balance, not necessarily using his strength and his muscles, but also using his brain.
For Louisville, Knowles back in for McGee, who just picked up his second. Brad Wanamaker, a freshman from Philadelphia, doesn't get a ton of playing time. More since the injuries happened. Mike Cook out for the year. LaVance Fields missed 12 games. Pittsburgh just 5 of 12 Len from the line. And we've seen a lot of great passing, great effort in our games here. We have not seen very good free throw shooting in our games here.
Again, watch Blair behind David Padgett jumping from side to side to disconcert the passer as well as not allow Padgett to know where he is.
That is a terrific save by Jerry Smith, who is just now getting back onto the court. Sosa on the penetration.
Oh, nice.
No look pass to Padgett. And he comes up empty.
It was a pretty pass there.
Sosa's done a nice job distributing the ball tonight. Taken away by Palacios, having a great first half. All the way. Yes!
A veteran. Nice job with the strip. Taking it all the way. Jerry Smith right here going for that save a couple of possessions ago. And not only did he keep his eye on the ball, he wanted to make sure he saw where he was landing.
Palacios, the three-point play. Back and forth. Louisville and Pittsburgh have gone throughout the first half. We're fully anticipating our next game will be just as good as this one. Marquette and Notre Dame in our next quarterfinal. About 20 minutes after the conclusion of this one tonight here on ESPN.
And there was a change in defense from the full court pressure. Instead of a zone, it was man. And Pittsburgh took a long time recognizing it, but not an awful long time to knock that one down.
A good look for Ronald Ramon. The Panthers back on top. Pittsburgh ball. Smith turns it over.
Earlier in the game, it looked as though Louisville was throwing kind of a zone press, which means guys are playing a spot. And here, it's pretty much a man. Even though it looks like he's playing a spot, they back off. And then they pick up a man.
Len, as you well know.
Now they drop back in a 2-3 zone.
A huge key for Pittsburgh. They've kept Blair on the floor. He's only picked up one foul here in the first half. Turned over by Ramon. Preston Knowles. And a good decision to slow it down. Now Smith off the glass. No. Looking inside for character. What a matchup that is with DeJuan Blair.
Good job, Jerry Smith. Tempted to go inside with a lot of defenders surrounding character, but got it back out to Sosa to get a restart.
Into the post, character. Double team, forces it up.
Character wanted that one too much. Needed to kick it back outside and reset.
At the other end, Blair defended by Palacios. Good help by Jerry Smith coming down. And a timeout, 30-second timeout called by Jamie Dixon.
Yeah, Jamie Dixon didn't like the fact that his offense was bogged down. Wants to talk about it.
We'll step aside with a minute 20 to go. A one-point game here at the Garden.
It hurts. Boy, that hurts. Squeeze it out, Jackie. Ah, I can't do it. Hey, I'm Jackie Moon. I work out a lot. In the 24/7 battle against odor and wetness, guess what I use? Nothing? No, this. Old Spice. Pro strength and a perspirant. Look it up.
A one-point lead for Pittsburgh over Louisville. The winner advances to the semifinals here with the Big East Championship. And we've got them for you tomorrow night. First, Georgetown and West Virginia at 7 Eastern. The Hoyas took care of Villanova today. West Virginia beat Connecticut. Then the winner of this against the winner of our next game, Notre Dame and Marquette. The Big East Championship presented by Aeropostal, a part of Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Big win for West Virginia today. Joe Alexander, 34 points for the Mountaineers. Georgetown hit 17 threes in their win. Big days for Jonathan Wallace and Jesse Sapp. Character, great position inside, and Ramon on his back.
Well, Ramon's looking for a little help from the officials. His character gave him a forearm to the chest to get that position. But when you're a little guy playing with the big fellas inside, you're going to expect a little bit of contact.
Into the final minute of the first half, yet another lead change as Louisville goes back up by one. Gilbert Brown wide open in the corner, missed everything. And the foul against Wanamaker of Pittsburgh.
Gilbert Brown a little disappointed with himself. You mentioned him wide open. And he's not a bad three-point shooter. His numbers don't reflect how much he's improved over the last several games with the time he's been given, only 25%. But he's hit some big shots, particularly in that come-from-behind win against Syracuse. Gilbert Brown was Johnny on the spot with a couple of big threes.
He was the guy who got most of the minutes after the season-ending injury to Mike Cook that happened on this floor back in December. Jerry Smith knocks down the first. Smith, a sophomore out of Wauwatosa, Wisconsin. Terrence Farley will come to the game for the first time for Louisville. Palacios out, and LeVance Fields will come back in for Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh will get the ball back. The shot clock is turned off, and the Panthers will try to hold for one last quality shot.
After LeVance Fields picked up his second foul, Jamie Dixon doing a nice job of inserting him in short stretches so they can take advantage of his effectiveness at the point, but also not leave him out there long enough to be exploited on the defensive end, possibly pick up their third.
But the New York City guards going at one another, Fields and Sosa.
Yeah, you know they know each other.
Yep.
Look at that hard head by character. Forces Fields away.
Good help by Knowles. And a great defensive possession to the end there by Louisville to preserve a three-point lead. Seven ties and 10 lead changes in the first half. Louisville 33, Pittsburgh 30. Doris Burke with Rick Pitino.
Coach, you gave up 9 offensive rebounds, but you were able to keep them under 40% shooting. What did you like? What didn't you like about your defense?
Well, just what you said, playing great defense, but then you waste all that energy giving up a second shot. We're playing a good basketball game. They're a tough team. We're a tough team. It's going to be a well of a game.
Pittsburgh is trying to keep you spaced against your pressure. How can you turn them over more in the full court?
I think we're inches away from turning it over. But more important, Doris, is we're wearing them out. We're substituting a lot more. We're wearing their guards out. And that may prove key, a key element in the second half for us. It may not.
Thanks, Coach. Dan?
And Doris, Louisville's been a great second-half team all year long. They've got a three-point lead at the break over Pittsburgh. Now let's go to Reese Davis, Digger Phelps, and Bob Knight in the studio with the Cisco Halftime Report.
All right, Dan, you can feel some serious intensity in the Garden tonight. Coach, what do you think about the level of play you've seen so far?
I think the game with Louisville and Pittsburgh is the best game we've seen so far. From both ends of the floor, both playing against each other, I think what they've done is narrowed it down to a 20-minute game. Now, Pittsburgh made a couple of mistakes at the end that allowed Louisville to go up by three, but, boy, I think that this has been a heck of a basketball game.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think both coaches know this is a what chess match. And I think when you look at what's going to come down this game, last 2 minutes, who controls the boards, who makes the free throws.
All right, West Virginia and UConn set the stage with an entertaining game earlier in the day. Huskies have lost their last three in the Big East tournament. Here's the team to beat.
He was not a factor today. He was in foul trouble. He scores here. He only has 6.6 rebounds, and you'll see why.
What did you think about the way the Mountaineers played, Coach?
Well, I think you got to start, obviously, with Alexander, who's, again, my choice as the most valuable player on any team in the country right now. They did a great job handling the ball.
And from that, Alexander was able to put on an exclamation point.
I think that in addition to the ball handling, I think West Virginia did a very good job with its patience.
West Virginia able to win the game 78-72. They move on to the semifinals. Villanova and Georgetown. JT3, the whole program never lost a game when they were the top seed in the Big East tournament. Antonio Pena has his shot blocked. Patrick Ewing Jr.
Here we go.
Kicks it out to Chris Wright. Georgetown up, but Villanova would come back. Got close. Georgetown, what'd you think of the way they passed the ball?
I thought Georgetown's passing was the best I've seen all along so far, Reese, and I think their patience went along with that and obviously started out with 6 out of 7 threes and then ended up with 17, and their half-court defense was very, very good.
82-63, the final. Digger, what about Villanova and going to the tournament?
I think they don't have a shot now. They're 7-6 their last 13 games, but they've only got 2 wins against the top 50 in those 7 wins, and that's not good enough to me as an at-large.
So Villanova's going to be sweating it out, maybe on the bad side of the bubble on Selection Sunday. Right now, higher seed is advanced in every game in the Big East right now, with the exception of West Virginia and UConn.
Well, you know, I don't think there are going to be any upsets. We mentioned that this afternoon, and I don't think the seeding is at all important from this point on in any of the league tournaments. And certainly, as I said, there isn't going to be an upset.
And that's what you look for now. Maybe not in a conference tournament, but more importantly, you're playing now for big seeds. It's a difference between being a 2-3 seed or a 4 versus a 1 seed. Don't be a 5 because the 12s are going to beat people this year.
And any seed, if you can just get in, if you're one of those bubble teams, the one you want, and a couple of teams perhaps hurting their cause this afternoon. Arizona State played a tight game with USC. We'll show you how the Sun Devils came out and what impact it might have on them. And what a bad loss do in Baylor. We'll see.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. And Bud Light. Endless refreshment from start to finish. Bud Light keeps it coming.
Nike Shox A-Rod, only at Dick's Sporting Goods.
Bud Light is brewed to give you everything you want in a beer. Never-ending refreshment, superior drinkability, and now the ability to breathe fire.
Allow me.
Wow.
Do you have a cat?
Fire no longer available in Bud Light. The endless refreshment, however, remains.
Bud Light keeps it coming.
I'm really sorry.
Even more dreams will come true during the 2008 Disney Dreams Giveaway. Like an overnight stay in the Cinderella Castle. Magical Dream Fast Passes and other surprises. Becoming Grand Marshal in Disney parades around the globe. Even stay overnight in the park in the Disneyland Dream Suite, originally designed for Walt Disney himself. It's all going on now as part of the Year of a Million Dreams at the place where dreams come true. Visit DisneyParks.com.
Meet Marshall Brain, expert explainer.
And I'm really curious about everything. Tonight, we're going to break apart golf balls. Titleist will show us their secret recipe, baking them at over 300 degrees. And boats flying at up to 55 miles per hour. Who knew they could get so much speed from fiberglass shot out of a gun?
Who knew? With Marshall Brain, part of Engineering Thursdays, premieres tonight at 9 Eastern on Nat Geo. Channel 101.
Ring of Honor World Champion Nigel McGuinness is a marked man. Challengers from all corners of the wrestling world are gunning to knock Nigel off his throne. Former ROH champion Austin Aries knows what it takes and will stop at nothing to regain what he believes is rightfully his. Will Aries prevail? Will Nigel show him that he's in it to win it? Don't miss the explosive action at the worldwide premiere of Ring of Honor Rising Above. Playing this month on pay-per-view.
Welcome back to the Cisco Halftime Report.
Big 12 tournament, Colorado and Baylor. Colorado's a 12 seed, and 5 seeds are 10-0 all time against 12s in Big 12 tournament. This one hit down to the wire and then some. Curtis Gerrals ties it at 65. Same score, closing seconds. Marcus Hall of Colorado throwing up the three. A front iron, and we're going to overtime. 20 seconds left here. Baylor down two. Gerrals misses, but lays Darius Dunn to tie it at 74. Closing seconds. Hall is going to have another shot for Colorado on the drive. Baylor with the rebound. A little bit of time for Dunn. We're going to double overtime. There, Colorado builds up a lead with great play of Roby. Hall driving up. And what do you think of Baylor's chances with the loss?
I think Baylor's got real issues. You know, they lost 6 out of 7 from January 26 to 2-19. They have lost 8 of the last 13 games. They got no credibility.
Arizona State and USC, O.J. Mayo and James Harden, each outstanding freshman. Harden playing the passing lane nicely. He finishes up. Sun Devils up by 2.
I think this was a really tough game between both teams. USC, I don't think, played quite as well as they can. Arizona State thwarted them through most of the game with a pretty doggone good zone defense, I think. USC made good plays at the end to win with the aid of a pretty bad call.
And that is the one to which you refer, Jeff Pendergraft, with the follow. He was called for a foul coming over the back, so the basket was waved off. Mayo, as you saw him hit a couple of shots, was outstanding. And USC, 59-55 over Arizona State. UCLA blows out Cal, 88-66. So much for all of that talk about Josh Shipp and that late shot and the late no call in that game as well. Now, there's been talk about Arizona State and Joe Lunardi right now. His latest bracket update has the Sun Devils out of the tournament. Some saying maybe the Pac-10 should get 7 bids, Coach. What do you think about the play in the Pac-10?
Well, I'm not really as big on the Pac-10 as some people are, Reese. I think that there are some very good teams there. UCLA, Stanford, Washington State is a great team to watch play. I think that the thing about Arizona State is, above all else, that Herb Sendek and his staff deserve tremendous credit and recognition for what they've done with that team. And I know they're there, and I hope things go well for them, but I think there'll be a lot of other teams being considered in the same level that Arizona State is.
Arizona State has big wins. They got a win over Xavier. They've got a couple over Arizona with that first round loss, even though it was tight. They'll be sweating on Sunday as well. Back with more after this.
This halftime report is presented by Cisco. Welcome to the Human Network.
If your bike won't start, try changing the spark plug.
Hey, what do you think?
Go there.
Okay, on
your
way.
Welcome to a network where video changes everything. Cisco, welcome to the Human Network.
I found it. One medicine for my seasonal allergies. Veramis Nasal Spray. I've got the power of one to treat all my nasal symptoms. All my eye symptoms, too. It's true. Veramist is FDA approved to treat seasonal nasal and eye symptoms.
For best results, use once daily. Side effects may include nosebleed or nasal sores. Nasal fungal infection, glaucoma, or cataracts may occur.
And for your first 30 days free, go to Veramist.com. Ask your doctor about Veramist for seasonal allergy symptoms. The power of one.
In college, you weighed 425 pounds.
Then you said,
enough!
Put together a game plan.
He ate better, exercised,
and real fast. 245 pounds.
245 pounds.
That's twice what I weigh.
Gone.
Jared, for taking it off.
And keeping it off.
10 years.
Practically a lifetime.
Great job, Jared.
Woohoo! Way to go, Jared.
Bravo.
Woo!
10 years and 245 pounds later, congrats, Jared, on an amazing feat. Happy to help with our mouth-watering low-fat subs. Subway. Eat fresh.
Never buy a used car without a Carfax vehicle history report. Ask your dealer or go to carfax.com.
Switch to Valvoline's Max Life, and there's no telling how long your car will keep going.
Sweet.
Max Life not only protects against friction, but also leaks, deposits, and sludge. The four major causes of high mileage engine breakdown. Drive it forever.
Hey, honey, did you pack my flip-flops?
What,
hon? Did you pack my flip-flops?
What?
I can't find my... I need my... Really?
Travelocity will contact you ahead of time if your hotel's undergoing construction.
It's gonna be great. It's gonna be a big week.
Part of the Travelocity guarantee.
Whee!
Travelocity. You'll never roam alone.
This halftime report is presented by Cisco. Welcome to the Human Network.
The day is drawing near. Selection Sunday just around the corner. This is our schedule. ESPNU Bracketology Show at 5 o'clock Eastern Time and 7 o'clock as well. 6 will be on SportsCenter. Digger, Coach Knight, Jay Billis, Hubert Davis, the entire gang. Keep you up to date with Joe Lenardi as well. Selection Sunday schedule on Bracketology. And Florida might be waiting on that NIT bid because in the first round of the SEC tournament, they are getting obliterated by Alabama. At least they're on a 6-4 run right now to get it back from that 30-5 deficit.
A little different than getting that trophy we saw before we came to the break.
Just a little bit. Still time to go in the first half.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. And Mercedes-Benz, located on the web at mbusa.com.
Nike Shox A-Rod, only at Dick's Sporting Goods.
Most of the people we built the M-Class for will never drive across the desert.
Most people will never need windshield wipers that perform at Autobahn speeds.
Most people will never make a mountain rescue.
We'll never need the strength of over 5,000 welds.
Or scale a 70% slope.
But the truth is, some will.
And knowing that, we cannot engineer anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
Select Sector Spider. Visit us on the web at sectorspdrs.com or call 1-800-THE-AMEX now.
Sir, I'm calling about your son.
My son's in Iraq.
Your son was in Iraq.
A soldier returned, but never came home.
He wouldn't leave without telling us.
No, we'll find him.
Now, his father must uncover the truth.
See that soldier in here?
You do not question the witnesses.
Figure somebody should.
My deepest sympathy.
You don't have a child, do you?
My son deserves better than this.
You have no idea what we did over there.
It's his voice on the video.
What video?
In the Valley of Ella.
Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
A four-year-old child is on the street.
From the author of Mystic River, when they brought him in.
Look, I don't care who does it. I just want it done.
But they never expected what he would uncover.
They stole the little girl, and you knew about it, and you did nothing.
Where I come from, you die with your secrets.
What did you do? Oh, no, thank God.
Gone, Baby Gone. Rated R.
Fios TV On Demand brings you thousands of the hottest shows and movies anytime you want.
When the dream that drives you is closer to reality, that's what this show is about.
You want reality TV?
Here it is.
You want reality TV?
Here it is.
You want reality TV?
Here it is.
Once the whistle blows, tip off, no fear exists.
Come on.
You want reality TV?
Here it is.
You want reality TV?
Here it is.
Big East on ESPN, that's where it lives.
And only one of these two teams will live to see the semifinals. Here tomorrow night, Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. We are at the Big East Championship presented by Aeropostal inside of Madison Square Garden in New York City. A game with multiple ties and lead changes in the first half. We got a good one going. Louisville and Pittsburgh, as Len, we revisit our key matchup of the night.
Yeah, the big fellas inside really jockeying for position as DeJuan Blair walks David Paget underneath. And here, Blair continues to keep Paget occupied, going from side to side. Paget can never get a feel, and Blair comes up with the steal. And here, just a Blair sandwich. But David Paget, not to be undone, or outdone, I should say, again, doing what he does as the conduit of that offense. And here on the offensive glass, once again, even though he's 7 feet and away from the basket, he kicks it. They wind up with a bucket.
DeJuan Blair held to just 2 points last night against Cincinnati, 10 points in the first half tonight. And David Paget, again, a little bit of everything. The team just runs more smoothly when David Paget is on the court. Keith Benjamin of Pittsburgh begins the second half with 3 fouls. LaVance Fields' minutes were limited in the first half. He's got 2 fouls as we are underway here in the second half.
And Louisville's sticking with that zone, essentially really bothering Pittsburgh, forcing them to exhibit even more patience than they normally do. And then it's the turnovers.
Doris Burke had a chance to visit with the Pittsburgh coaching staff. Doris, what's up with them?
3 points of emphasis. One, take better care of the basketball after they advance against Louisville's pressure. They felt like they allowed Louisville to speed them up once they crossed the half-court line. Two, continue to be physical rebounding. And Lenny on the defensive end against a screen and roll. They want to do a better job on a slip. Louisville scored 3 times off that.
Well, here in transition, got 2 guys back. A nice job there.
And Benjamin put in the situation where he has to take the foul. It is number 4 on him. As we check out our first half stats tonight, presented by Guinness. Points in the paint dominated by Louisville. They've got a lot of big bodies, and they were able to get in around the rim. Great job by the Louisville bench as well, led by Earl Clark. And now foul trouble for Pittsburgh. Keith Benjamin sits down with his 4th. A blue guy on this Pittsburgh team, Gilbert Brown, replaces him.
And the point Doris made about taking better care of the basketball once they beat the trap. You have to be concerned if you're Jamie Dixon. Only 4 turnovers in total in the last game. Here so far they've got 8 on Pittsburgh, and they've got a, also from the free throw line, they've missed 7 free throws. So those are lost opportunities and lost possessions.
Palacios the foul, his 2nd. Blair to the line. How much upside is there for this freshman?
Well, in college basketball, tremendous amount of upside. I'm hopeful that he decides he wants to stay the full term because he can just get so much better. And, you know, as far as being undersized, with his reach and his smarts, as well as the skill, he could be a terrific power forward on the next level.
And as he said, Doris, can't measure the heart. He's got a huge ticker, and his motor's always running. Palacios left the layup a little short. Blair snags the rebound.
And that's another way to beat pressure, make some stops. Louisville doesn't set up in that full court pressure unless they've scored.
Ramon mishandles the pass,
oh, nice,
and Brown swats away the Smith layup attempt.
Dan, you talk about some timing right here. Not only the hand-eye coordination to get to the ball, but also to avoid the contact. And there was at least 1 foot of space between Brown and Jerry Smith.
Gilbert Brown, the redshirt freshman, with some serious hops. Earl Clark back into the game for Louisville. Paget, jump hook from the baseline.
Well, that time David Paget able to receive down low, and you see what he brings to the table. Variety of moves, and that jump hook, which is virtually unstoppable if he's under rhythm.
Again, ball pressure by Louisville. Ramon breaks it. Brown the lob. How about that?
Well, now we've seen everything.
I guess we have.
4-point plays, tremendous blocks, and now a change of possession the hard way.
Now when the ball gets stuck between the rim and the backboard, it goes to the arrow, which turned it over to the Cardinals. McGee lobbing inside. Paget.
Blair doing a nice job of keeping Paget as far out of the paint as he possibly can and keeping him away from his strong spot offensively.
Clark got a finger on it. It wouldn't stay down for him, but it will stay with Louisville. Earl Clark played well in limited minutes, picked up a couple of fouls in the first half, but had 8 points off the bench for Rick Pitino. The winner gets the winner of Marquette and Notre Dame tomorrow night in the semifinals. Clark's taking some high percentage shots here tonight, Len.
Well, he's doing the right thing, letting the game come to him and taking advantage of the opportunities presented, as you mentioned, in a short period of time.
And as you mentioned, he's the one guy Pittsburgh may have the most difficulty matching up with. 6'9", great athlete. Young from 17 feet away.
Well, against this zone, if Sam Young can get into that sweet spot and his team can find him, he's kind of the perfect guy, can handle the ball and read the backline defense. But if they stay back, he can knock that 15, 17 footer down in his sleep.
Young's the guy who draws the assignment of Clark at the other end. Smith misses a three. Brown skies for the rebound. Fields scoops it up. Everything but the finish, rebound Clark. McGee blocked by Young. End to end they go. Young shakes a defender. Padgett got a finger on it. Young gets it back and misses again. Gets it back again and finishes.
Offensive rebounding. Rick Pitino certainly not happy with his team giving up 3 and 4 opportunities. But the tenacity of Pitt.
Block shots at both ends of the floor. We got a 1-point game at the Garden.
ESPN360.com, your online home for championship week.
While we were building our life,
something else was building in my arteries, dangerous plaque. It had been building up most of my life. My doctor said it's a progressive disease called atherosclerosis.
And with his high cholesterol, he prescribed Crestor to help slow the buildup of plaque.
Along with diet, Crestor lowers bad cholesterol, raises good, and is approved to slow the progression of atherosclerosis.
Is Crestor right for you? Ask your doctor.
Crestor isn't for everyone. Like people with liver disease or women who are nursing, pregnant, or may become pregnant, simple blood tests will check for liver problems. Tell me about other medicines you're taking, or if you have muscle pains or weakness. That could be a sign of serious side effects.
Talk to your doctor about plaque buildup and find out if it's time for Crestor.
If you can't afford your medication, AstraZeneca may be able to help.
Most of the people we built the M-Class for will never drive across the desert.
Most people will never need windshield wipers that perform at Autobahn speeds.
Most people will never make a mountain rescue.
We'll never need the strength of over 5,000 welds or scale a 70% slope.
But the truth is, some will.
And knowing that, we cannot engineer anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
Back at the Pitt Panthers' second home, as they like to call it, Madison Square Garden. They're down 1 to Louisville. You know, you don't make first team all-league in a league like the Big East unless you've got some skills, and Sam Young has some skills.
Well, he certainly does. And leading by example sometimes is an overused phrase, but if you want to overcome a deficit, these are the effort indicators. The ability to go down on defense, get back, blocking shots, and then second and third chance opportunities on the board. Those are effort points that Sam Young has demonstrated, and he's hoping his team follows.
More on Sam Young with Doris Burke.
Well, you don't have that kind of elevation, guys, without healthy knees. And over his first 2 years, that was a struggle for Sam Young. It is rare when a coach has to tell a player, stay out of the gym. But Sam, a guy who after practice would take on the managers in games of one-on-one. And if the managers didn't want to play, he'd go to the rec center and take on anybody from the student body. He just loves the game, loves to play. He actually had to take 2 weeks off to get the knees healthy. And that's been a huge help, guys.
I gotta love a gym rat, even if it's a little bit too much. Most improved player in the Big East, increasing his scoring average from 7.2 to 18 points per game. Good effort by Terrence Williams, but Pittsburgh ball nonetheless.
Well, again, with Sam Young, it's all about opportunity, meet, and preparation. Didn't get the minutes, as you could see, last year. And now, almost doubling those minutes, doubling his output.
This is the 30th game that Pittsburgh has played in this building in the last 8 years, a combination of Big East tournament games, preseason games, St. John's games. Jerry Smith on the drive, and he is fouled by Ronald Rameau. And I think it's going to be before the shot. Now it's going to be two shots for Jerry Smith as we go to the under 16 media timeout. Well, you know they love their hoops here in New York City, and they're getting plenty of it this week.
Most of the people we built the M-Class for will never drive across the desert.
Most people will never need windshield wipers that perform at Autobahn speeds.
Most people will never make a mountain rescue.
We'll never need the strength of over 5,000 welds or scale a 70% slope.
But the truth is, some will.
And knowing that, we cannot engineer anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Anything less.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
Than a true Mercedes-Benz.
New prototype. Let's see what the skaters think.
Is it working?
It's better.
Got a little revolution. Cause I roll better too. I call it my inspiration.
Welcome to a network where instant feedback creates instant success. Yeah. Cisco, welcome to the human network.
Challenge doesn't build character. It reveals it. Through the market's ups and downs, Oppenheimer Funds has proven we have what it takes to keep moving forward. Just one reason why Barron's has recognized Oppenheimer Funds for having some of the top portfolio managers in the business. Oppenheimer Funds, the right way to invest.
Carefully consider fund investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses. Call your advisor for a prospectus with this and other fund information. Read it carefully before investing.
This mocha java chiller is great.
Yeah, this caramel mocha java chiller is really good.
This is a perfect frozen treat.
It's actually just coffee.
No, frozen treat.
Coffee. I'd like to have the last word.
Then go ahead.
Coffee drink.
It really is a coffee drink, Brian.
Again, I'd like to have the last thing
that's
said.
But I was agreeing with
you. I know, but I want to have the last thing that's said. This is good.
Mm-hmm.
Java chillers at Sonic. A shot of premium roast espresso blended into an indulgent frozen treat of your favorite flavors. And stop in for happy hour. Half-price fountain drinks and slushes every day from 2 to 4 p.m.
Checking in on the SEC tournament, Florida trying to play its way in, and they're getting blown out of the Georgia Dome at the moment. The freshman Rico Pickens, a little lob for Alonzo G in the punch. Alabama has Florida doubled up nearing halftime, 46-23. This is what the Gator resume looks like, 500 in a weakened SEC this year, and the strength of schedule not so much, not only because of the non-conference games they play, but because the SEC has several teams outside the top 100.
Well, Reese, that, as you well know, would fall under the heading of a bad loss for the Florida Gators, and it might seal their fate in terms of making the NCAA tournament. Here are the top nine in the Big East by RPI. With West Virginia beating Connecticut earlier today, I think you can say the top seven are a lock. Villanova beat Syracuse Leonard, what many considered to be an elimination game yesterday. Villanova lost to Georgetown today. Jay Wright's got to be disappointed. Obviously, his team lost, but many other so-called bubble teams, Baylor, Arizona State, UAB, now Florida, struggling or have already lost. And who knows? There might be some teams that think they're out who sneak into the tournament this year.
Well, it's going to come down in many instances to that comparison of schedules, who you played, where you played them, and how you did. Tom O'Connor, the chairman of the tournament selection committee, has mentioned that time and time again. And particularly if there are head-to-head battles. And that's why right now the nod goes to Villanova as opposed to Syracuse And it came down to Syracuse being in that bunch.
The trap by Louisville forces a Pittsburgh timeout. If you're a fan of any one of the bubble teams, tune in for Ohio State against Michigan State tomorrow, 2 Eastern, here on ESPN. A pivotal game for the Buckeyes as they try to solidify their resume. And we've got the semifinals for the Big East Championship tomorrow night. Georgetown and West Virginia led by the red-hot Joe Alexander at 7 Eastern. And the winner of this game against the winner of our next quarterfinal tomorrow night. The Big East Championship presented by Aeropostale tomorrow night. Georgetown is the number one seed. They've never lost a game in this tournament when they've been the number one seed. West Virginia into the semis. Joe Alexander. For people who are saying, oh, yeah, West Virginia, I remember them. Pitts, Noggle, Gansey. Well, those guys are gone. For people who don't know about Joe Alexander, what do they need to know?
He's about as athletic as any top-flight player in college basketball. He can put it on the floor. He can shoot it, and boy, can he shoot it right now. He's really developed into a tremendous scorer.
He's averaging 30 points per game in his last 5 games.
It's all because of that jump shot, whether it's conscious or willful in the improvement, but he's got a little bit of arc on it, and he's giving himself a chance to have some of the ones that might be a little bit errant to bounce in.
Character inside, muscles it up and in. The foul on Blair. Good minutes tonight for Derek Character.
Well, you can see Derek Character came out here with a mission, and that was to try to get something done against DeJuan Blair, another young big man down low. And Character, again, using his strength. Nice post-up ability, and really turns right into the face of the defender, Blair, and that's where the contact occurred.
By the way, back to Georgetown and West Virginia just for a moment. Folks may remember another one of the nail-biter games in this league this year. As they go over the top to Blair. That's the way to break the press.
And what court vision by LaVance Fields, who had a double team in front of him. I don't even know how he saw over them. Fields about 5'9", 5'10". Was almost hidden by the double team.
1-point lead, Louisville. Terrence Williams cannot convert on the alley-oop. Young from the baseline. Pittsburgh takes the lead. There is no quit in the Pitt Panthers. Never has been, never will be with this group that they've had, really this run they've had the last 7 or 8 years. And you could say the same about Louisville. As Rick Pitino said to Doris at halftime, they're a tough team, we're a tough team.
Officials letting them play. A lot of contact out here. And the moment I say that.
Well, LaVance Fields trying to calm down Sam Young to make sure that Young doesn't pick up a technical.
Well, again, breaking the pressure. And up here is Derek Character. Watch him and take a look right there. That's where DeJuan Blair is. Character loses him. Goes with the wrong guy. Never even sees Blair behind him. When you're the last line of defense in your pressure, you've got to account for all 5 guys in front of you.
Fields with an assist to turnover ratio on the season of about 3-1, an outstanding ratio. And in the regular season, a matchup between these two teams, had 7 assists and did not turn the ball over, and may have just been whistled for a foul. And he was. It'll be number 3 on Fields as we visit with Dorsey.
Well, in a 9-day span back in December, 2 major injuries to Pittsburgh for Jamie Dixon. Mike Cook against Duke on December 20th. On the 29th against Dayton, LaVance Fields an injury. And for the most part, guys, on a national stage, this team was written off. They did not think they'd get back to the NCAA tournament. Jamie Dixon never blinked, guys. He and his staff kept the same approach, and the guys will tell you, their ability to absorb those issues without worrying or changing their expectation has had major impact on their ability to be successful, guys.
And think of it this way, as Young knocks down another jumper, they returned 2 starters from last year's team. Those are the 2 guys who got hurt, Cook and Fields. So for a large part of the season, they were playing with a group of 5, none of whom had a lot of starting experience.
Well, that also tells you that Jamie Dixon has a tremendous system in place where guys know exactly what they're supposed to do, and all they have to do is step up their preparation and intensity and fit right in. Doesn't have to change much with the change of personnel.
Pittsburgh by one in a back-and-forth game. Off the fingertips of Ramon out of bounds. Bouncing behind us into the lap of former Notre Dame great LaPhonso Ellis, who's getting ready to make the radio call of the Irish and Marquette, the next game that we'll have for you here on ESPN. And there's Mike Cook, one of the most popular, well-liked players on the team, a torn ACL midway through his senior season, his collegiate career over. And LaVance Fields, his closest friend on the team, near minutes after Cook was injured, knocked down a three in overtime right in this building to beat Duke back in December.
That last possession gave you an opportunity to see how the disruptive Louisville half-court defense will make you throw those high-risk passes.
Palacios way off on the three, and back come the Panthers with a one-point lead. Blair not in the game right now for Pittsburgh. Young. And Palacios with another rebound.
And without Blair in the game, Louisville able to extend their defense a little bit more.
Offensive foul, Edgar Sosa. And Rick Pitino is going to make a change at the point right away. Here comes Andre McGee.
I'm not sure I saw what a foul was. I know Sosa's left arm made contact, but it didn't look like it was a push-off. But nevertheless, the foul was called. So many guys today in basketball are using that off arm to kind of shield that sometimes do get away with a push.
McGee replaces Sosa at the point. Clark back in for Louisville as well. Clark right now matched up on Ramon. A 6'9 forward on a 6-foot guard.
But the athleticism of Earl Clark combined with that length, he can give some room to Ramon, but not that much room.
The wrong guy to leave open if you're Louisville. The Oakland Zoo is in the house tonight here in the Garden. Pittsburgh's up by four. Let's go back for a Sports Center right now. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, Dan, we'll crank up Sports Center right now with a little baseball. Curt Schilling's going to be on the shelf until at least the All-Star break. The Red Sox putting the big right-hander on the 60-day disabled list to continue to rehabilitate his right shoulder. And Greg Oden, a former Ohio State star who's been sidelined the entire season with right knee surgery, practiced for the first time, went through some offensive drills, even threw down a dunk. Sports Center on ESPN News 11 Eastern. Stay current with ESPN News all the time.
Thank you very much. Back here in New York City, Ronald Ramon left open, and Lanny bangs down his third three of the night.
And Earl Clark will learn with a guy like Ronald Ramon, if you have him, you better keep him. Here's Clark, and here's Ramon. Look at that space between them. You got to be able to get back, especially if he's a shooter. And this guy's need to tell him, if you got him, keep him.
Padgett calling for it. The immediate double team by Young. And Padgett's pass off the fingertips of Williams out of bounds.
And you see Rick Pitino telling this guy, this is where you got to be.
Louisville a little bit out of sync offensively right now. Pittsburgh feeling it. They're up by four.
Lost in a daydream of blue, and I feel so free. And then it's like I fall from the sky. Everything that I see.
The 2008 Volvo XC90 SUV. Meet yours at the Get Together with a Volvo spring sales event. Lease or purchase one today and receive a Garmin Nav unit. Ends March 31st.
Yeah! Touchdown!
Honey, can you please check on Grandpa?
You okay, Dad?
First down!
I'm getting worried about him. First the door-to-door salesman, now this.
So the old guy thinks he's watching football. I kind of envy him.
Yes! Yes!
Catch all the football you've been missing. Watch Russell Athletic ESPN Arena Football Monday at 8 as the Colorado Crush battle the Dallas Desperados on ESPN2.
I'll handle this. Sunday, March 30th, only on pay-per-view.
Did you know that when you advertise your business, you may not be getting your whole market? And what if every time you advertised, your market wasn't complete? Via Media offers affordable local television advertising on major cable networks. And Via Media now offers these networks and more on Verizon Fios. At Via Media, we provide advertising solutions and think your business deserves the complete market. Via Media, more of the big picture.
Tonight's game is also available in high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia. New York City, Madison Square Garden, the home of the Big East Championship for the 26th consecutive year. The longest conference tournament run in one city in the history of college basketball. And Luke Herangode, the Big East Player of the Year, is looking to make his mark in this tournament tonight. We've got Notre Dame and Marquette in our fourth and final quarterfinal coming up right after this game. The winner of that will play the winner of this in the semis tomorrow night. You like a big, physical, strong guy on the inside who can throw some people around? Luke Herangode is your guy. He had a 40-point game against Louisville during the regular season.
Well, that was an example of watching the Bull enter the China shop.
Hey, but you know what also? The Bull knocked down three threes in that game, the only threes he's ever made in his two-year career at Notre Dame.
Didn't say he wasn't a skilled Bull.
But you're right. He's a Bull. And Marquette, they don't have a whole lot of Bulls. They got a lot of skill, but it's going to be interesting to see how they defend Herangode in game number two. Fields from the elbow.
And hope Tom Crane's hope is that his guys come out playing defense, but not like Matador.
This 6-point lead, Len, the largest lead of the night for either team.
When you look at the number of lead changes, 13, shows you how closely fought this game has been.
Earl Clark is knocked down by Sam Young. And Clark shaken up just briefly.
Let's take a look here on this drive, just penetrating, getting to a spot, forcing the defender back on his heels. And with his penetration skills, I'd like to see LaVance Fields do that a little more often. If he can be that kind of a threat, boy, it opens up an awful lot for him down the road to be able to create for others.
Well, about 6-7 years ago, the point guard was Brandon Knight, and then he gave way to Carl Krauser, who gave way to LaVance Fields. And I think one thing all three of them have in common is great toughness, physical and mental toughness for all three guys.
Hey, New York City metro area, you get that on the playgrounds, inside the community center. They don't call fouls out there.
No, that's right. If you know what's good for you. Tyrell Biggs got it. Long range jumper by Biggs. Pitt is up 8.
And Biggs coming in replacing Sam Young. And we talked about him just a bit. He needs to eat some minutes. He needs to be effective while he's out there as he spells the frontline guys.
McGee with a floater, left it short. Clark has it blocked by Blair. The Panthers are playing right now.
Howling and flexing. When even for a moment, you can be king of the jungle. And right here, just a tremendous job by Blair. Just holding his ground, waiting until Clark leaves his feet. And that's what survival's all about. These guys right here are just playing it.
Sosa misses a layup. Padgett is fouled on the follow. Boy, Louisville's got to finish, not the Padgett one, but they've got to finish. The other guys are a little bit better around the rim. Tonight, Subway, fresh back, is only one team has won the Big East Championship having to play four consecutive days. That was Syracuse a couple of years ago, the great run by Jerry McNamara. They beat Pittsburgh, who also that year played on the Wednesday. It's not easy to win four games in 4 days. West Virginia's into the semis, having played yesterday and today. Pittsburgh trying to get into the semis, having played yesterday as well. We're talking about no day off between games. You're talking about guys like Padgett and Palacios playing with bad or surgically reconstructed knees. This is a true test.
Well, it certainly is. And again, we talked about that survival in there amongst the trees and amongst the guys who want to battle and bang. I don't think you think about the injuries when you're in there just trying to get by, trying to get over and then some.
And we're talking about two coaches who would dearly love to win this tournament. Not all coaches feel the same about conference tournaments, but for Pittsburgh, the success they've had in this tournament is a source of pride in their program. Into the championship game six of the last 7 years, winning it in 2003. Rick Pitino has won 8 conference tournaments in his collegiate coaching career. His best success, of course, coming at Kentucky.
Pittsburgh trying to get inside that zone, trying to beat it inside out. No luck, and now it breaks down, and Fields has to create something.
In and out. And the rebound to Biggs. Ramon wide open. Rebound to Brown.
A good decision by the Benson. Fields hears it to bring it back outside and reset. This is what we talked about, methodically building a lead, utilizing patience and execution.
Fields penetrates. Nice kick to Brown for the slam.
That's pretty good execution.
Not bad, huh? Pittsburgh's confidence growing by the minute. They are up 8 on the number 2 seed, the Louisville Cardinals. Terrence Williams for 3. Big shot for Louisville. And Williams' first points of the night.
And he's the right guy to be able to take it. Terrence Williams just cares about winning. He doesn't mind giving up himself and his opportunities to shoot it if it makes other guys better. But when they need him, he's got to be there.
Louisville beat Pittsburgh by 2 at Pitt during the regular season. Pitt has knocked Louisville out of the Big East tournament each of the last 2 years. Fields step back jumper. Tough shot over Sosa. Off the fingertips of Knowles. Saved by Palacios. And we will stay here with 8 minutes left. It'll be Louisville ball as there are mass substitutions for both teams.
Well, Rick Pitino talked about it when Doris spoke with him about wearing Pitt down. And I think Jamie Dixon very cognizant of that. And he's shuffling his guys in and out, trying to keep fresh legs out there to maintain this league. And Rick Pitino obviously keeps throwing guys at him, hoping that through fatigue, his team can get back in it.
Benjamin back in for the first time in a long time for Pittsburgh. He's got 4 fouls. Padgett fouled by Blair. Blair his 3rd. But other than that, just about everything is going right now for Pittsburgh. Check out this execution and the high-flying Gilbert Brown. Pittsburgh's got a lead on Louisville, trying to advance into the semifinals.
Lost in a daydream of blue, and I feel so free. And then it's like I fall from the sky. Everything that I see is you. Oh, I adore you.
The 2008 Volvo S80 luxury sedan. Meet yours at the Get Together with a Volvo spring sales event. Lease or purchase one today and receive a Garmin Nav unit. Ends March 31st.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Aeropostal. Make it happen. And in part by Volvo, who believes that life is better lived together. Volvo for life. And Jordan, become legendary.
Right now, over on ESPN2, the ACC tournament, first round, Virginia and Georgia Tech. Zach Peacock strong for the Yellow Jackets. They have an 8-point lead, just over 9 minutes to play.
And Reese back here in New York, the Big East Championship presented by Aeropostale. Tonight's Valvoline Game Track. Pittsburgh leading Louisville by 5. Sam Young, another nice night for the Panthers. Pittsburgh shooting over 50% here in the second half. Louisville, by the way, only 28% in the second half. A good job by the Louisville bench. What do the Cardinals need to do better down the stretch, Len, to win this game?
Well, they certainly need to rebound, particularly on the offensive glass. They need to get to the free throw line, because against Pittsburgh, when they played them, they had far more free throws than did the Panthers.
Pittsburgh is over the limit already. 18 fouls this half. Louisville has committed only 3. Padgett to the line, 64% on the season.
Yeah, it's all about the easy opportunities and the free throws, particularly Louisville because of their defense. But Pittsburgh doing a nice job weathering the storm and then some.
Clark, the offensive rebound. Now Clark launches and knocks down a long 2.
And that's what I mean, getting second chance opportunities. Giving them a chance to put the ball in the basket and then set up this full court pressure, which will wear Pittsburgh down, not only physically, but also mentally.
It was Louisville by 3 at the half. It's Pittsburgh by 2 now. This ball moving again by the Panthers, but then Benjamin's pass off Young's hands out of bounds.
Pass was a little errant, but the problem I have with Sam Young, you got to go after those with 2 hands. So many turnovers in feeding the post occur because the receiver only goes after the ball with 1 hand, and any kind of bump from the defender will knock him off balance and ultimately miss that one.
Pittsburgh's been in so many close games this season. Doris Burke has more.
Well, guys, one of the things Pittsburgh's been able to do over the last several weeks for the first time since December is have productive practices. As they've gotten healthier, the things they've focused on, live game action, thinking when fatigued, special situations where they've got a 2-point lead with 7 to play, Lenny, it's about time to think game management.
You're absolutely right, Dorison. That's what makes the return of LeVance Fields so important. Not to take anything away from Ronald Ramon when he was running the point, but Fields had that extra creativity level that ultimately gets guys in place and can do so many things, and the ability to hit the big shots, although Ramon's hit his share. But here against the pressure right now, you need a couple of good ball handlers on the floor.
And although this is Fields' 9th game back from the broken foot, this is the first week where he's really been able to practice every day, and that has helped him immensely in game situations, having another healthy body in practice. On the switch, Palacios on Fields. Trying to take advantage of the mismatch inside. Young fouled by Jerry Smith.
And what I liked about Sam Young's play on that one is he recognized he had the smallest Smith on him. Could have settled for a jump shot, but instead, utilizing that ball fake to gather himself, he took Smith down into his territory down low, and Smith forced the foul.
Palacios out as Terrence Williams returns for the Cardinals. Blair. One-on-one with Padgett. Offensive foul. Good call by Jim Burr. That right arm of Blair right into the chest of Padgett and land number 4 on DeJuan Blair.
And you take a look, as opposed to the first half when Blair used his shoulder, there's that right arm. And that's why the official called it. And it's a good call, because he got that right arm out there. Had he continued to use his shoulder in a way that was using his strength and backing David Padgett down, I doubt if that call would have been made.
So Blair goes out for the Panthers. McGee misses the shot. And it's out of bounds to the Cardinals with a fresh 35. That's a gut check time right now for Pittsburgh with Blair on the bench. Biggs is in the middle for the Panthers.
And somehow we knew that Biggs would play a role here, having to give Blair a blow and be productive for the minutes that he's in.
Jerry Smith for 3. Rebound Clark. Off the glass and good. Earl Clark has been the X factor tonight for Louisville.
Yeah, did we foreshadow it in the first half? Again, his length, his quickness, and his ability to get to the basket. And now, add to that a willingness to take some big shots. That makes Earl Clark so very dangerous.
14 points and 5 offensive rebounds tonight for Earl Clark as Louisville takes the lead. They have answered a 9-0 run by Pitt with a 9-0 run of their own. And again, Rick Pitino said to Doris, we're going to try to wear them down in the second half.
And every place you go, if you're a backcourt player for Louisville, you got a guy, maybe two guys in your face. And again, mentally, that starts to wear on you.
5.5 to go. Cardinals by 1. Paget fouls Fields. Number 2 on Paget, 15 foul.
And how about Fields recognizing the mismatch? Boy, his eyes got wide open.
Not a whole lot Paget can do, and he's got a 5'10 point guard trying to drive by him. Second foul on him, back into the hands of Fields.
Need to be looking for young bigs inside.
Good look here for Fields. Great rebound by Young, knocked out of bounds.
Well, that's what you give up on the zone. Offensive rebounding position, and Sam Young, veteran, recognizes that. He's positioning himself on that weak side.
A couple of big nights for Sam Younglin. 21 points, 6 rebounds, 4 blocks last night. 15 points, 9 rebounds, 4 assists, 2 steals, and a block tonight.
Well, he's had to work for him. You look at that field goal percentage, 6 of 17. But nonetheless, it's all Big East. First team.
Yep. 1 of 11 on the Big East all-first team with the 16 teams in the league. They go bigger as well on their conference teams. And right on cue, 2 more for Sam Young. Pitt snaps the drought and retakes the lead.
This is the stage upon which you play like a first teamer.
Terrence Williams. Offensive foul. I think the basket is going to count, is it? Michael Stevens looked like he motioned that the basket would count as he now talks it over with Jimmy Burr.
Well, once that ball leaves his hand before the contact, that's pretty close. And here's Sam Young busting to that spot.
And the two officials continue to talk it over. The signal again looked like the basket would count.
Such a tough call.
It is credited to Terrence Williams. And he is called for the offensive foul. The ball had been released, or called for the foul. The ball had already been released. That's the 17 foul. So now 1 and 1 of the other end for Tyrell Biggs.
Well, once again, the ball leave his hands before the contact. Very close. And the reason why, if the basket didn't count, it would be a player control foul.
Right.
And the shots would not be taken.
Yeah. Same situation happened in one of the day games today. But not a player control foul once the ball leaves his hands. Count the bucket. The 17 foul, 1 and 1 for Biggs. One of 2, rebound Paget. A 2-point game between these two teams in the regular season. Louisville winning that one. All tied up, 4.5 to go with a spot in the semifinals on the line.
One of the major differences between that game and this game, Pittsburgh only 4 turnovers, even in a losing effort. But today, they've got 15 turnovers, and the game is tied. It's a close figure.
Clark getting set to check back in for the Cardinals. Fields trying to drive by Sosa. The kick to Brown. And the foul on Terrence Williams. His 4th.
Well, how about Gilbert Brown with that hang time? We've seen him already attack the glass and flush it. And here, look at the hang time. Driving to the basket, hangs, waits for the contact, and still able to get the ball up to the basket.
So Williams becomes the third player in this game to pick up his fourth foul. He will stay in the game as Carriger and Clark come back in for Padgett and Palacios. Brown, a redshirt freshman, getting more minutes since the injury to Mike Cook and giving Pittsburgh an extra dimension athletically. Under four to go. Clark inside. Whoa. Wasn't sure he was going to be able to reach the rim from where he was, but he got there.
One of the guys in the Fantastic Four, man.
Biggs playing assertively tonight. Bad shot, though. Rebound Clark. Louisville looking to run.
Nice outlet there.
Oh, great steal. Sam Young.
Jerry Smith, I think his shooting is bothering him, making some uncharacteristic mistakes down the stretch. And the fact that he's not lighting it up on the offensive end might be affecting his game.
Nearing the three-minute mark, all tied up at the Garden. Smith blocks Fields and saves it.
I guess I better be quiet, huh? He gets that focus back.
Boy, what a fun game this has been. Marquette and Notre Dame still to come here on ESPN tonight. Williams. Oh, Carriger might have gotten away with a push. Tyrell Biggs is looking for a whistle that didn't come. Carriger gives Louisville a two-point lead. Sosa fouls Fields.
But Biggs may have an argument, but the point is, in this kind of game where the officials have allowed guys to play physical, you've got to be able to hold your block out. And Biggs is big enough to hold his block out.
2.5 to go here in the Garden. One team's going home, the other is going on to the semis.
My batter is better than your batter. Thank you very much for coming.
Lost in a daydream of blue, and I feel so free. And then it's like I fall from the sky. Everything that I see is you. Oh, I adore you.
The 2008 Volvo XC90 SUV. Meet yours at the Get Together with a Volvo spring sales event. Lease or purchase one today and receive a Garmin Nav unit. Ends March 31st.
There's no looking back now. The time to let your resume speak for itself is here. Which teams will be granted a spot in the bracket?
That is a very tough first round matchup.
Who will be left out in the cold?
They got a raw, raw deal.
This is the team that has the easiest way to get back to the Final Four.
65 schools have a chance to cut down the nets. Our team will prepare you to pick one champion. ESPN U Bracketology, presented by Staples. Sunday at 7 on ESPN, followed by Black Magic Part 1.
Rich Davis with you in the Big 12 tournament. Nebraska and Missouri playing for the right to meet Kansas. J.R. Strober's going strong. Alex Marich there to follow. 59-56. This game stays like this. ESPN2 will take you there for the end in bonus coverage.
Memphis rolls in Conference USA. Chris Douglas Roberts with 17. Alabama continuing to hold its lead over Florida, who desperately needs to avoid a loss.
Well, you never know, Reese. We might need a little bonus coverage here at the Garden tonight. The way this one is going, a two-point lead for Louisville. 2.5 to go. Earl Clark off the bench, a huge force in this game.
Well, Earl Clark, the sixth man for Louisville, and Rick Pitino coached a little bit up in Boston. The Celtics made the sixth man famous. It came down to having a guy like John Havlicek come off the bench, forcing the other team to have to match him. And if you couldn't do that, you weren't going to have any success. And right now, Pittsburgh unable to match Earl Clark. We said it, the X factor, foreshadowed it in the first half, and he's living up to exactly what we expected.
And on the floor right now, along with character, Padgett is on the bench. 1-1 for LaVance Fields, a 72% free throw shooter on the season. There have been 18 lead changes and 10 ties in this game.
And how valuable is it to have a guy like Earl Clark, better than anybody on the other side can match off their bench?
The 11th tie of the night. Quarterfinal action of the Big East Championship presented by Aeropostal from Madison Square Garden in New York City. The winner of this game will advance to the semifinals tomorrow night against the winner of our next game tonight, Marquette and Notre Dame. Georgetown and West Virginia are already into the semis. Clark tied up, play on.
Nice job of recovery. The double team on character, and then when Clark made the cut, that double team turned on Clark.
Fields on a switch with Clark on him now. Young trying to take the mismatch with Sosa. Sosa flopping. And Young banks it in. A great job by the officials not to buy the flop.
Yeah, and it was a high risk for Edgar Sosa because Sam Young, such a tremendous perimeter shooter, you're just giving him a clean look. Take a look right here. Sosa knows he can't do anything with Young, so he just drops and hopes that the officials give him the benefit of the doubt. But they didn't buy it, and Young fills it up.
Pittsburgh now leading by two. Black Magic tells the story of the injustice which characterized the civil rights movement in America, as told through the lives of basketball players and coaches who attended historically black colleges and universities. Black Magic, presented by Russell and State Farm on ESPN, Sunday night at 9 Eastern, and then another two-hour show Monday night at 9 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPN.com.
And you know the beauty of that scheduling? You know, every kid that's playing college basketball of every ethnicity has a chance to watch it. Selection Sunday is over, Monday's an off day, and they need to pay attention because you don't know where you're going until you know your history.
Well put. Pittsburgh leading by two. A minute 45 to go. Clark being pressured by Young. Plenty of time on the shot clock. McGee has replaced Sosa at the point for the Cardinals. Smith driving on Ramon, scoops it up, no good. Pittsburgh ball.
And this is usually where Pittsburgh excels. Half-court execution. Vance Fields, the consummate ball handler.
And a timeout taken by Pitt. Well, the Panthers are no strangers to games that have gone right down to the wire this season. And one of the first ones in which they played this season was right here on this court. How slim is the margin between victory and defeat for so many teams this year? Pitt with big clutch wins against Duke, West Virginia, and Syracuse.
Well, make no mistake about it, that's a skill, learning how to play and win close games. Some luck involved, but you got to train for it. You got to practice for it.
Fields, tough step back jumper. And Padgett, I think, is going to get called for the foul. What a job by DeJuan Blair underneath.
Young big fella against experienced big fella. And sometimes youthful enthusiasm can win out. You take a look underneath, Blair just battling and battling David Padgett, who just cannot withstand the push. And look at him holding him, trying to keep Juan Blair off the board any way he can.
Blair's first miss of the night after making his first four, 62% on the season. He'll get one more. He has left the door open for the Cardinals.
Boy, the ninth missed free throw by Pittsburgh. And if they come on the short end of this, they're going to be thinking about this for a long time.
Defense! 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 15 to shoot. Padgett, left hand, blocked by Young. Clark on the follow, tie game. 19 for Clark.
Vance Fields holds up his hand with one. They want to take the last shot.
They've got a timeout. And they'll use it.
Ball goes inside to David Padgett. He makes a nice strong move. But there's Sam Young as Blair tries to contain Padgett, but no one there for Earl Clark. And it's really, Earl Clark is Sam Young's guy. And he just gets around as Young makes the good play. But Earl Clark doesn't stand there and admire that play. He's working.
Clark with 19 points, 9 of 14, 9 off, 9 rebounds, 6 of them offensive. None bigger than that last one. But Pittsburgh's got the ball with 16 and a half seconds to go. No timeouts for Pittsburgh. The shot clock turned off. 19 lead changes and 12 ties in what has been an entertaining game from the moment it began.
Well, right now, looking in this huddle, Jamie Dixon has to talk about a couple of contingencies. Obviously, if Louisville comes out in zone, they're going to try to look, weave the ball inside out possibly. Look for spot-up shooters as well as an opportunity to go to the basket. And if Louisville comes out in man, you can expect a high screen for LaVance Fields. But Fields, so adept at creating off the bounce, you know, he may be able to get into the paint without a high screen. But always expect Ronald Ramone to be lurking somewhere where the penetrator can find him for that jump shot.
It was Ramone who knocked down the three that beat West Virginia last month. Double bonus both ways. The arrow with Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh's got the ball out of timeouts.
And Louisville, in fact, comes out in zone, or you can never tell with a Rick Pitino team. Got a lot of nuances.
Down to six. Fields. Overtime at the Garden. He got a decent look from deep in the corner, and he did not miss by much. Pittsburgh 62, Louisville 62, overtime on the way.
Nike Shox A-Rod, only at Dick's Sporting Goods.
This mocha java chiller is great.
Yeah, this caramel mocha java chiller is really good.
This is a perfect frozen treat.
It's actually just coffee.
No, frozen treat.
Coffee. I'd like to have the last word.
Then go ahead.
Coffee drink.
It really is a coffee drink, Brian.
Again, I'd like to have the last thing
that's
said.
But I was agreeing with
you. I know, but I want to have the last thing that's said. This is good.
Mm-hmm.
Java Chillers at Sonic. A shot of premium roast espresso blended into an indulgent frozen treat of your favorite flavors. And stop in for happy hour. Half-price fountain drinks and slushes every day from 2 to 4 p.m.
Rich Davis with you in the studio. Get you up to date on Alabama and Florida. And here come the Gators. Desperate, and they've cut a 25-point deficit to 9 thanks to some poor free throw shooting by Alabama. And still a ton of time left for Billy Donovan's team to pull it out.
Well, Reese, Pittsburgh tried to pull it out right at the end of regulation. Len, take us through the last play.
Well, again, the ball is in LeVance Field's hands, as it should be. But what it comes down to is an opportunity for DeJuan Blair. Watch him put his hands up. Right here, I'm open. But what he needs to do is come here. He's got a chance to seal right there. And now when the ball handler takes it down to the corner, you got him sealed. The double team comes as an opportunity to drop it down to him to get a higher percentage shot. Fields couldn't see Blair on the other side of the floor. That play bogged down, but we got free basketball.
We got at least 5 minutes of free basketball and another game still to come between Notre Dame and Marquette. Kickball, it'll stay with Louisville. Gonna be tough on Mike Bray, Tom Crean. They're ready to get their teams on the floor. Now they've got to sit back and wait. As Jamie Dixon's Panthers and Rick Pitino's Cardinals duke it out here in this quarterfinal. Smith throws it out of bounds.
Yeah, Jerry Smith just in one of those funks. Normally, heady player out there doing a lot of positive things, but sometimes you compound the errors trying to think too much instead of playing the game.
One of the nine shooting the ball tonight. Three turnovers for Smith. McGee at the point for Louisville over Sosa. Padgett and Clark, the big guys in the game right now for the Cardinals. Two-three zone. Ramon feeds it inside. Blair is fouled by Clark.
Oh, that's excellent ball movement. Got it to the sweet spot, forced the defense to contract. He kicked it to Ramon, and the defenders closed on Ramon, and he found Blair nicely. This is what I mean by sealing. On that last play, you see how Blair sealed it? Ball went to the corner and went right down to him. That could have happened at the end of regulation, but Blair decided to stay on the other side of the basket.
Blair knocks down a free throw. Remember, he missed a couple of free throws near the end of regulation. Sosa back in for Smith, a two-point guard look right now for Louisville. And struggles at the line for both teams tonight. Pittsburgh by two. There are four players with four fouls, three of them currently on the floor. Williams and Clark for Louisville, and Blair for Pittsburgh.
Hard double team. Padgett tries to dribble to a spot where he can turn and see the floor instead of get trapped down low in the short corner.
The handoff to Williams. Thought about the shot. That one partially blocked. Blair the rebound.
Well, you know, when you get to overtime, it really comes down to defense and rebounding. Offense usually takes care of itself, but the team that can string together a couple of stops is the one that emerges victorious.
Well, both teams have to protect the glass. Each has given up too many offensive rebounds tonight as Sosa comes up with a steal.
Sosa back in overtime in place of Smith.
Williams driving. No call. There was a lot of contact. Looked like the defender might have been set, but it's a play on, and back come the Panthers.
And again, Terrence Williams, uncharacteristic of him. That was just a pull-up jump shot. Instead, he tried to force the issue. Got to take what the defense gives you in this situation.
Just 2 of 10, Len, for 5 points. And we've got a foul away from the ball going against Louisville.
See, when you're a guy with a extraordinary athleticism as Terrence Williams, you've got an opportunity to take what the defense gives you. Right there is a pull-up, not a leaner, but a pull-up jump shot without changing the ball direction or anything, and just fundamentally sound, hit that backboard. But oftentimes you get caught up in trying to make too many things happen instead of taking what you're given.
Palacios in for Williams. Louisville goes bigger. The foul was on Sosa, his third. Ramon knocks down the first. And the Pittsburgh lead is out to four. Louisville dreaming of a Big East championship, a seed potentially as high as a number two if they could win this tournament. A loss here in the quarters could knock them down a notch or two. Pittsburgh safely in the tournament, projected by Joe Lenardi, our bracketologist, as of this morning, as an eighth seed. So they're looking to improve that and also to continue a solid run of success here in the Big East Championship. Padgett follows the miss by McGee. Two-point game.
Well, complete backline defense of Pittsburgh flew to McGee, which left that weak side in the front of the rim open for offensive rebounding.
A very patient Pittsburgh team offensively in recent minutes. Blair flashes into the middle of the zone, looking for help. Bounce pass to the cutting Ramon. Got it!
Now there's where a little bit of luck helps. Over pursuit by the defense gives Ramon an opportunity to score.
13 for Ramon, four of them here in overtime.
Well, here, this is a tough bounce pass to handle in a crowd. You know, right there, got a little bit of a hand on it, did Sosa. But the defense, again, kind of over-pursued. Earl Clark, instead of protecting the basket, went after the ball and left it open. Now, you take a look at David Padgett right here. When he goes to the basket, the whole defense goes to the drive. Now, watch him. High screen. He goes to the basket. Here's the drive. Everybody goes there, and Padgett all by himself under the basket. You got to communicate if you're the back line. I got him. Stay at home. Things like that.
Now these Louisville Cardinals, they've got some veteran players on this team. Some of them have been around for three or more years, and they have experience getting knocked out of this tournament by Pittsburgh each of the last 2 years.
And you know, recognizing that, Dan, that last look on Sosa's face, Louisville may still prevail, but I'm not sure. I'd like that look on Edgar Sosa's face. I know he's a winner. He's done some tremendous things. But there was a point in time when he was looking like he's almost exasperated. You got to open those eyes wide, man, and pay attention, because this may be an opportunity where you guys can pull the game out instead of kind of resigning yourself, at least a resigned look. I'm not saying I know what's inside his head, but just the look on his face, I'd like to see him a little more attentive and a little more excited, because they still have a chance, plenty of time left.
Oh, yeah, four-point game, almost 2 minutes to go. Here in overtime, Marquette and Notre Dame waiting patiently for their opportunity to take the court here at Madison Square Garden in New York. Earlier today, it was Georgetown over Villanova, 82-63. The Hoyas knocked down 17 threes, a school record. West Virginia defeated Connecticut 78-72. Joe Alexander with a career-high 34 points. The Mountaineers and the Hoyas at 7 Eastern tomorrow night here on ESPN. The winner of this one and the winner of the Irish and the Golden Eagles in the second semifinal tomorrow night just after 9 o'clock. Step back. 68-64, Pittsburgh.
Now I know why Sosa had that look. He's been taken out of the game. Yep. Derry Smith had a little bit of that look earlier. Seems like Rick Pitino is trying to find somebody, some combination out there that's not going to make a mistake. Each time a guy made a mistake in the last several possessions, he's taken him out and replaced him with someone else. But at least Smith's getting a second chance, and Sosa will too, I'm sure.
And Terrence Williams stays on the bench. Double team on Padgett. He spins to the baseline. McGee wide open for three. He has not found the range tonight. What a rebound by Clark, but he's stripped by Brown.
Yeah, and a mistake he made with all the effort getting to the basket was bringing that ball down below his waist and making him the same size as Ramon.
Clark now with a double-double, 19 points, 10 rebounds, but time is ticking away on the Cardinals. Fields with a floater. Got it! 6-point lead, just over a minute to go.
That was New York City on those perforated backboards at the playground right there.
Palacios. And Clark over the back. Earl Clark is out of this game.
And he deserves a tremendous hand for what he's brought, but this one mistake, watch him bring it down. He probably couldn't help it because he was losing his balance. But when he did bring it down, it was Gilbert Brown that got to him. And then here's LaVance Fields. Probably done this 100 times, 1,000 times, playing travel ball or playing in the local rec center. I guess he's saying foul.
Eric Pitino wanted a call he didn't get. What a night for Earl Clark, but he fouls out as Sam Young goes to the line, and Pittsburgh inching closer to a spot in the semis.
And that just shows, you see, Rick, that just shows how bad he wants this game. He never likes to lose. But playing here in New York City is special. Winning here is even more special. And that's not lost on a native son like Rick Pitino. And it probably, if they do lose, it probably hurts even more than a regular loss.
A couple of teams, each of which has dealt with a lot of adversity. Louisville, the injuries to Padgett and Palacios. Pittsburgh, the injuries to Cook and Fields. Jerry Smith wide open. His shot not there tonight. Out of bounds to Louisville. Both teams playing with a tenacity. You know, that maybe you trace back to the injuries in the adversity and the things these teams have overcome this year.
Well, take nothing away from Louisville and the effort they displayed out here. Again, played excellent defense. Earl Clark came in and gave them a huge lift. Guys like Jerry Smith just couldn't knock down shots.
Sosa inside. Young might have gotten a piece of that. Sam Young has had two terrific nights here in New York.
And then you give the credit on the other side. We talked about what happens in overtime. It's all about defense and rebounding. And once you can string together some stops, you usually win it. And Pittsburgh strung together more stops than Louisville in this instance.
Biggs in there as well, I think, went on the block. Yeah, Biggs got a piece of it. You saw the shot of the Louisville bench. The faces are getting longer and longer for Louisville. And Pittsburgh is getting closer and closer to its third consecutive win over the Cardinals in the Big East Championship and a spot in the semifinals. And remember, Pittsburgh has been to the championship game of this tournament 6 of the last 7 years, and the Oakland Zoo is feeling it now.
Well, this is the second consecutive loss after a long string, a 9-game winning streak for Louisville. The redemption is, or should come in the NCAA tournament, if that's any consolation. I know it isn't right now.
Palacios for 3. Timeout, Rick Pitino. 20 seconds to go. A 7-point lead for Pittsburgh, a team that has found a way to win close games, as we told you. The wins over Duke, good at West Virginia, Syracuse, now perhaps Louisville in overtime as well. Should Pittsburgh advance, they will meet either Marquette or Notre Dame in the semifinals, and they suffered double-digit defeats to each of those teams during the regular season. But again, those games, they were a different team then than they are now. Healthier now, as we check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Dan, we've been keeping an eye on the reigning national champions. At least those jerseys won the championship last year for Florida against Alabama. Richard Hendricks blocks Chandler Parsons' shot. Brandon Hollinger finding Mikhail Riley. And Alabama just about squandered all of a 25-point lead. Gators got it down to 6. It's an 11-point edge for the Crimson Tide now.
And as you mentioned earlier, Reese, a desperate situation for the Gators, trying to come up with another win and improve their stock in the eyes of the tournament selection committee.
But it's a different season. You get in conference tournament play, and the young Gators, not a lot of those guys have the experience out there. At least the leading guys have the experience of playing in that SEC tournament.
Fields back to the line for Pittsburgh. Counts. Pitt has made their free throws here tonight. They missed a couple right at the end of regulation. Blair did. But in overtime, the Panthers are a perfect 9 of 9 from the stripe.
You talk about game management, as Doris alluded to earlier. You give that credit to this man right here, able to weather the full court pressure, able to get the ball in a position for guys to succeed, knock down a couple of big shots and free throws himself.
Will Scott into the game for Louisville. The handoff to Padgett. And Pittsburgh with a gutty performance here in the Garden. They will beat Louisville in overtime and advance to the Big East Tournament semifinals tomorrow night. Fields, Young, and company dispatching Louisville. The Cardinals have lost back-to-back games for the first time since December. And Pittsburgh is on to the semis, where they will await the winner of our next quarterfinal game tonight between Notre Dame and Marquette. Our final score from Madison Square Garden in overtime, Pittsburgh 76, Louisville 69. Coming up next, College Game Night presented by Liberty Mutual, and then our fourth and final quarterfinal from the Garden after that between Marquette and Notre Dame. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Don't forget to join us for the Irish and the Golden Eagles coming up from the Garden about 20 minutes from now.
Welcome to College Game Night Update, presented by Liberty Mutual.
Glad to have you with us. Marquette and Notre Dame coming up in just a little while. Reese Davis, Digger Phelps, and Bob Knight. And as Coach Knight said earlier, no upsets when you get this deep in the Big East tournament. The 7-seed Pittsburgh moving on. And Digger, the reason is largely because of that grit we've seen from the Panthers all year.
People may forget this, but go back December 20th when Pitt knocked off Duke in Madison Square Garden. DeJuan Blair had 15 points, 20 rebounds. Pitt lost Mike Cook that night, a great player, and they really recovered. But then all of a sudden they lose who? LaVance Field, their quarterback, their point guard. This team now has that maturity, they have the confidence. And, Bob, you know, if you got a great leader like LaVance Fields that can run a show and they dominate the boards like they did inside tonight, and when you look at Sam Young, another great player, they just got it done in overtime against Louisville.
Well, you know, we said last night that Fields was a tremendous factor in their win last night, and he had 6 assists and 1 turnover, scored 10 points. Now, in the ball game tonight, he goes with 6 assists, 1 turnover, and scores 13 points. And he was a real vital factor in eliminating as much pressure as Louisville could extend. And I think that as this game started, I thought a lot about the match between the inside players, and that was pretty good. And this game came down to the very end between two very good teams, well-coached teams, tough playing teams, but Pitt made 9 out of 9 free throws.
That's right.
At the end of the game, and at one point at the start of the game, they'd made 5 out of 12.
Yeah.
And Pittsburgh, who has been in 6 of the last 7 Big East championships games, an opportunity to make it 7 out of 8. UConn, on the other hand, had lost its first game 3 straight years, but it always had been to Syracuse. At least they weren't playing Syracuse. Huskies against West Virginia, a team to beat, working hard inside, but